Good afternoon, everyone. This is Preeti Sagar, and welcome back to Editorial Discussion. So I have taken up all such important editorials which had been published in The Hindu and Indian Express in the last one week, you can say. So first article, that is about mixed bag, restoring health of every constituent sector is a must for long-term growth in exports. Basically, this article is talking about India's merchandise export and the growth which has been seen and which had been found in the merchandise export. And it has been said, the crux of this article is that it has been analyzed, it has been found that merchandise export of India that had increased as compared to last year, as compared to 2020. There were certain reasons in 2020, COVID-19 had outbreak had been seen. And because of COVID-19, economic activities had been stopped. So whatever exports India did last year, comparatively this year, we have gained a lot. Okay, so base year, that was last year. And on that base year, we have, it was found that we have our export had been increased. But if we see the base year as, if we take the base year as 2019, so comparatively 2019, 2021 export is also increased. Okay, that has also been found increased. So here it means that there are, that the export of India is very much, there are certain field or there are certain sectors in which India's export had been found increased. So this is a very good indicator for India's economic growth, basically. So this is relevant for GS paper 3. And context of this article is about that India's merchandise export had reached an all-time quarterly high. So quarterly high, it means on June 30th, when first quarter had ended. So it was found that $95 billion we have earned in the 3 months that provided welcome cheer on the economic front. So in the export, we have earned $95 billion, which was very, very, very much high in the first quarter. So the record had been notched up during a quarter when second wave of pandemic hit its peak amid varying degrees of lockdowns is all are the more noteworthy. It means during COVID-19's second wave, what India is facing right now, we are tackling up the second wave. So, and in the first quarter, it got started. So in that situation as well, our export had been increased. It was found, it was increased. And various, regional lockdowns had been imposed. So in that situation as well, our export sector was working well. So export last month has surged to 47% from June 2020 to $32.5 billion. And the discounting, by discounting the fact that year earlier period provided an anomalous base as the economy had just begun reopening from a protracted nationwide lockdown. Growth in shipments was still a robust 30% when compared to the pre-pandemic June of 2019. It means when last year, so last year, if we take as a base, okay, base year. So base year was 2020. So it was found that because of lockdown, lockdown and after reopening of economy, growth in shipment has been found. It was 30% increase had been found comparatively during pre-pandemic year. It means in 2020 as well. From 2019, 30% increment in the export had been seen. Okay, propelling the surge from 2019 levels were non-rice cereals. So non-rice cereals, that was found a surge as compared to 2019 level. So that got quadrupled. It means four times rise had been seen in the non-rice cereals. Iron ore, that was more than doubled. Organic and inorganic chemicals, that has been rose by 62%. It means these were those sectors which performed very well in the export. Okay, as compared to, or you can say if 2019 was the base year. So engineering goods export had biggest jump in dollar terms that added $2.73 billion in value or 42% over June 2019 as the rising vaccination coverage and economic recovery in key developed market, including European Union and US, bolstered demand. So when economic reopening had been seen in European Union and USA after vaccination drive completed, so India's engineered good export had been boosted in because of increased demand in European Union nations and USA. Okay, so it was found that the value was $2.7 billion. It was 42% increase as compared to June 2019 level in June 2021. So Commerce and Industry Minister Piyush Goyal was enthused enough by the export performance to posit the shipments of goods to overseas markets could touch $400 billion mark this fiscal, a figure which, if achieved, would represent an annual record. So it has been said by our Commerce and Industry Minister that we are about to touch, or we will touch $400 billion. If we will touch that, then what will happen? It will be a record for India's growth. So trade data that reveals that significant driver of the export growth has been the runaway rally in commodity prices that have benefited from the accelerated reopening of major economies, as well as an increased appetite of raw materials and grains in China. So China's economy has also opened, okay? And after reopening of major economies like China, raw material and grains, that has been, or you can say the demand of raw materials and grains from China had increased. So that has been said by trade data, okay? That is, this is a significant driver of export growth. So on the other hand, crucial job generating export sectors that include ready-made garments, leather and leather products, tea, all posted double-digit declines from June 2019 levels. So some of these sectors like ready-made garments, leather products, tea, so there we saw a decline in the double digits in June 2019 level. So it reflected deeper structural problems that dog each one of them. It means there is some structural problem in these sectors. So if tea industry has been facing long-term downtrend exacerbated by inadequate product variety, lack of market savvy, sharp competition from rivals including Sri Lanka and Kenya, leather goods segments has been put on the ropes by a combination of short-sighted policy measures, WTO mandated withdrawal of export incentives, and a pandemic-induced slowdown in the orders. Basically, tea industry has faced this downtrend. Why? Because of its rival, which is already present in the market, that is Sri Lanka and Kenya. So they are sharp competitors for these products of India. So leather goods segments that put on the ropes by combination of short-sighted policy measures. So because of short-sighted policy measures, we have seen the downtrend in the leather goods segment. So WTO has mandated its withdrawal of export incentives and a pandemic-induced slowdown in the order. So for a segment that provides large-scale employment, the recent imposition of an import duty on the key raw material has thrown the sector's very viability into question. So with the government dragging its feet on notifying the rates applicable under the remission of duties and taxes on export products scheme, so exporters are still unsure of how to price their products while bidding for orders. So basically, this remission of duties and taxes on export product scheme, so this scheme has been implemented by Government of India. So it has notified regarding the rates, okay, application under this remission scheme. So here exporters, they are unsure of how to price their products while bidding for the orders. It means they have to put minimum price to save themselves from the remission. Okay, remission, it means if they will put their price high, it means it will drop down the competition in the market. So they have to be in the competition in the foreign markets. So for that, they have to fix a reasonable price so that their products can be sold at good rates in the market, on the competitive price. So this is what a remission scheme does. Okay, so container shortage, heightened. So these are some of the problems, structural problems, due to which we have seen tea, leather good products, or other products. So there a downtrend had been found. So container shortage, heightened congestion have also sent freight rates out of Indian ports. So because of congestions and because of containers shortage, freight rates had been increased. Okay. And policymakers need to look beyond headline numbers and expedite actions to restore the health of every constituent sector if economically enduring long-term growth in exports is to be ensured. So if they want that long-term growth in export had to be ensured, then policymakers need to look beyond headline numbers, and they need to increase actions to restore the health of every constituent sector. It is not only about those sectors like engineering goods, like other goods, but they also need to take care of all such products, all such sectors like tea, where we have seen downtrend, leather products, where we have seen downtrend. So these are what double-digit downtrend had been found. So these products, basically, if structural problems are there, then they need some policy. Okay, so they need some good policy. So that, and they need to think beyond the headline numbers. Okay, so every constituent sector needs to be taken care of, and then only we can see, we can expect long-term growth in exports. Okay, so surety for long-term export can be found. So this is all about this article. We are moving on to the next one. Now, the heavy footprint of a light rail, a part of the land that has been earmarked for acquisition for the light rail in Kerala, are wetlands. Basically, this is regarding GS paper 3, and here Kerala, because the, if you see the topography of Kerala, where Kerala is situated. So basically, if you see its location, so it is in the it is part of, or it comes under semi-evergreen forest. Okay, so semi-evergreen tropical, semi-evergreen forest region in which Kerala is located. Another thing is that it is located nearby Western Ghats, or in the Western Ghats, you can say. So its topography is very much fragile. Okay, so if any constructive activity had to be go on, so for that proper conservation process need to be followed. Conservation of environment, basically. Every developmental work or infrastructure developmental work that had to be passed by the Environment Ministry after taking care of its fragility. Okay, they need to take care whether such developmental work is going to hamper its topography, its vegetation, its wetlands, water bodies or not. Okay, if environmental clearance is being given, then only that project or developmental project had to be given green nod. Okay, so context of this article is about light rail, that is a symbol of modernity that would surely appeal to the vanity of society's establishment, that is less evident though is the cost at which it could come. It means light rail, this is a modern technique. Okay, and for this modern technique, cost we have to pay as a human. So, or you can say environmental cost, what environmental cost we have to pay. So these are not just the upfront cost of installing one, but also the hidden environmental impact, which can vary enormously according to geography and project spread. So a light rail project has found favor with the government of Kerala. In Kerala, I hope you are aware that there is Marxist government. Okay. So, its unique selling proposition apparently is that it will reduce very substantially the travel time between two extremities of the state, that is capital city of Thiruvananthapuram in the south and town of Kasargod in the north. So it will basically reduce the distance between north and south Kerala. Okay, if this light rail project. So project has mostly drawn criticism from the environmental groups, but there are also economic consideration that must be brought to the table when judging its desirability. So see here, if we are talking, if we are thinking about economic progress, then there should not be, or there must not be any impact on the environment. So environment and economy can go together. Okay. There may be some impact on economy because of environmental conservation. There may be some impact on environment because of economic desires. So this need to be avoided. Okay, this need to be resolved. Then we have to move on. So it may seem odd to say this, as the economy is embedded in nature and we cannot ignore environmental cost. And there are instances when environmental impact of alternative projects is the same, but the economic returns vary significantly and vice versa. So the land here in Kerala, that is of undulated topography, that is combined with an often rocky surface that is prone to crumbling when dislodged. So rocky surface is there in Kerala. And if any infrastructural activity goes on, then what will happen? Dislodging of those rocky surface can be seen. So landslide problem can be faced by Kerala. So excessive quarrying and construction have already left it vulnerable to torrential rain. And that can be seen in the devastating landslides recorded across the state in recent years. The first thought that comes into the mind when contemplating another railway, light though it may be, is how it will impact the stability of the earth's surface along its course. So far, we have only considered the consequences of the land use at stake. Natural capital comprises not only the earth's surface and the services it renders to us, but also the ecosystem as a whole. So it has been pointed out that a part of the land that has been earmarked for acquisition for the project are wetlands. And these wetlands included paddy fields as well. So this is the concern. Paddy, which is a staple food for Malayalam or Keralite, basically. So its production in Kerala has been in the decline for over half a century. And part of this is explained by economic factors, but some part of it is due to lack of an assured water supply. So because paddy needs water, okay, for irrigation. So because of lack of water supply, earlier it has been said that because of economic factors, paddy production has been declined. But another factor, important factor, is lack of water supply. So double whammy of building over paddy fields and shrinking water bodies threatens food security. There is recognizable pattern of the developmental strategy of the present government in Kerala. 2 years before, it had dismissed protest by villagers of Kizhathur in Kannur district against highway project that would destroy their paddy fields. So if any infrastructural development has to go on, that must not impact the lives of the people. That must not impact that must not threaten the loss of land of people. And it had been seen when this Kizhathur village, people protested against this flyover or highway project. So it has, because they were losing their paddy fields. So it has now a chance to listen to citizens' concern on the plan to install a light railway across the state, the consequences of which will be far more widespread. So when highway project had been stopped, and now light rail project had to be given green nod, and for this is the symbol of modernity. And for this, what is the threat to the Keralites? The first threat is the landslide problem because of its rocky surface. Second is shrinking of paddy field, wetlands. Okay. Third is lack of water supply. So these are some of the issues which Kerala is facing right now. So it is not anyone's case that government should not develop transportation. It means they should develop. The point is that it should take into account all such alternatives. Kerala already has a railway line that is two-laned for the most part. There is an international airport in every urban conurbation, or it is well connected by roads with one of the higher road densities among the states. But of the highest promise are the possibilities of transportation over water. There is at present an ongoing project for the transportation through inland waterways. And finally, nothing prevents the government from developing a seaborne ferry service which is connecting Thiruvananthapuram with Kasaragod. That was in the news earlier, and all the ports in between. So if they want to connect north and south, okay, Thiruvananthapuram with Kasaragod, then there are other ways as well. Okay, there is connectivity of port that can be done. Ferry services can be done. So interlinking of waterways, okay, inland waterways connectivity, transportation, that can be started. So this would leave land untouched. They can improve inland waterways. They can go for ferry services, and it is very much feasible and less costly. Okay, so there is an irony in the pitch for a light rail by a communist government. Okay, so it is all political that they are going to build this project. And if they will go for alternative, then less fragility will be seen or fall on the land. So it will leave the land untouched, and it will also save people of Kerala, or it will also save population of Kerala from all such threats what we have discussed in this article. So this is all about this article. Moving on to the next one. Next is about financial stability report, which has been published by RBI recently. So context is that recently RBI released its latest financial stability report. What is the meaning of financial stability report? Basically, financial stability, the name says, It's about the financial stability of any country. There is Global Financial Stability Report, that been published by IMF. Okay, and it is about RBIs, which is in the context of India. So it is about the stability, financial stability of India in a year. So basically, it is published twice each year. It means in 1 year, two times it will be published. So this this financial stability report, this is one of the most crucial documents on the Indian economy, as it presents an assessment of the health of the financial system. Basically, this is the meaning of financial stability report. What it does, why it get published. It get published to analyze the assessment or to assess the health of the financial system of India, how it is working. Okay. And financial system of any country that basically that writes your faith. Okay. Sorry, that writes your fate in the world economy or at the world level economy. You know, if financial stability would be there in our country, then what will happen? We will get many good projects. FDI will come into our country. Then, export will be improved. Economic activities will be improved. Job generations will be taking place if FDI will come. So this financial stability report, it puts together a wealth of data and information that allows RBI to assess the state of the domestic economy, especially in the fast changing global economy. So equally important, this financial stability report also allows RBI to assess micro financial risk in the economy. So it is not only about assessment of India's economy, it is also about domestic economy assessment. It is also about assessment of micro financial risk. So micro financial risk, what does it mean? It means the risk that originates from the financial system but affect the wider economy, as well as risk to the financial system that originate in the wider economy. So for instance, if high percentage of loans that is extended by the banks in the past turn, and it has now it has been termed as bad or bad loans, okay, because it has not been paid since long time, because of lockdown or fallen demand of certain goods and services, this loan had become bad loan. So then such banks will be unable to extend new loans to the wider economy because their profitability would have been eroded. They have given loans because of lockdowns, because of COVID-19, they are not able to get their loan back or their interest back. So this has now converted into bad loan. So now this bad loan had impacted their profitability. Okay, it has dropped down their profitability. And because of this, they are now in not that position or situation that they can extend new loans to new business customers. So what starts as a bad loan problem for banks could turn into a massive roadblock for the growth of rest of the economy. So if banking functions would be halted, then another sectors will also not grow, will also not do good. So similarly, RBI tries to understand how a shock in one part of the financial system, the bank is affecting another part of the system, that is companies that financing housing loans. Basically, if who takes loans? Corporate houses, individuals, and individual companies and banking. Okay, so basically these are interrelated. So who takes loans? Either households or companies or private or government companies, they take loans. So if they are not able to pay back loan or loan amount or interest amount, then what will happen? Whatever profit bank used to earn, that will be dropped down. So now they are not able to extend new loans and they are not able to earn profit. And because of this, what is happening? New customers are not able to join the financial system. Okay, so as part of the financial stability report, RBI also conducts stress tests to figure out what might happen to the health of the banking system if broader economy worsens. Similarly, it also tries to assess how factors outside India, like crude oil prices or interest rate that is prevailing in another countries, might affect the domestic economy. So here it has also analyzed impact of crude oil in price increase, impact of interest rate increased, okay, in the different countries. So each financial stability report also contains the result of something which is called system risk surveys. So a year ago, India was still wrestling with the COVID, first COVID wave. RBI was also worried about bad loans that shooted through the roof. According to Financial Stability Report in June last year, depending on the level of stress in the economy, gross NPAs could rise from 8.5% of at the end of March 2020 to a two-decade high. That was 14.7% by March 2021. It means it is almost double, or lesser than a few figures lesser than doubling of gross NPAs percentage. So a year later, Financial Stability Report has found that actual level of bad loans as of March 2021 is just only 7.5%. So last year it has said that gross NPA is going to be increased, okay, from 8.5% to 14.7%. But in this year, to the March 2021, it was only 7.5%. So Financial Stability Report is quick to point out that macro stress test, it means it has dropped down. This gross NPA had dropped down. So a Financial Stability Report had pointed out that macro stress tests for credit risk shows that gross NPA ratio of scheduled commercial banks may increase from 7.4% in March 2021 to 9.80% by March 2022 under the baseline scenario and to 11.22% under a severe stress scenario. So in other words, while relief provided by the RBI in the past year, cheap credit, moratoriums, facilities to restructure existing loans has contained the number of Indian firms that openly defaulted on their loan repayment. Things could yet get worse, especially for these small firms like MSMEs. It all depends on the factors like evolution of virus and its impact on the economy and decision of central banks the world over, especially RBI, to raise interest rate to contain rising inflation and winding up their cheap money policy. So in the fact that even Governor Shaktikanta Das has observed that this is his forward. This is what a clear picture of NPAs that it is going to emerge only when regulatory relief provided by RBI is taken away. But it is not always clear when central banks should pull back such regulatory reliefs. So beyond NPAs, that has been the main concern for RBI over the past years. बेटा देखो, बैड लोन बेसिकली देयर इज नो डिफरेंस. ओके, बैड लोन को ही कभी कभी हम ग्रॉस का मतलब दी टोटल एनपीए. ओके, फॉर एग्जांपल वन कस्टमर, टू कस्टमर, थ्री कस्टमर, दे हैव व्हाटएवर लोन्स दे हैव टेकन, दे आर नॉट एबल टू पे इट बैक, सो इट हैज नाउ कन्वर्टेड इनटू बैड लोन. द टोटल अमाउंट ऑफ ऑल सच बैड लोन्स दैट इज टर्म्ड एज ग्रॉस एनपीए. एनपीए व्हेन इट इज टू बी कॉल्ड व्हेन बैड लोन कन्वर्टेड इनटू NPAs. It means it is about certain time period, like for 3 months if you do not pay your interest, so your loan amount will be regarded as bad loans because you are not paying your loan back, you are not paying your interest, you are not paying your principal amount. So in the first initial 3 months, this will be termed as bad loans. And later on, like for 2 years, 3 years, you left your loan like this, you didn't pay anything, then it will be named as NPA, non-performing assets. And the total amount of all such NPAs, this is called gross. Gross is what? Total, you know, in total. Okay, so kuch nahi hai, bas there is a difference of time period. Okay, so so beyond these NPAs that have been the main concern for the RBI in the last in the past year, the latest Financial Stability Report had provided some key pointers to the state of the economy. And what are these? First is about at less than 6%, the overall rate of credit growth is quite dismal. Ha, bilkul, ye total hai na, total NPA, the total amount of NPA, that is called gross. Okay, so basically NPA and bad loan, there is a difference. There is a difference of time period, and gross is what? The total amount. इसको ऐसे समझो, यू हैव टेकन अ लोन. ओके, फॉर एग्जाम्पल यू हैव टेकन अ लोन एंड यू सेड दैट यू विल पे योर इंटरेस्ट ऑन टाइम, बट फॉर सो एंड सो रीजंस, बिकॉज कोविड 19 हैड अकर्ड एंड यू आर नॉट एबल टू पे इंटरेस्ट बिकॉज यू आर नॉट अर्निंग एनीथिंग, योर बिजनेस हैड डिस्ट्रप्टेड, सो व्हाट यू विल डू, यू विल नॉट पे योर इंटरेस्ट. सो नाउ व्हाटएवर लोन यू हैव टेकन, इट विल बी टर्म्ड एज बैड लोन आफ्टर 3 months of the loan that you have taken. Okay, when time will lapse, okay, 3 month ho gaya, 6 month ho gaya, 1 year ho gaya, then it will be called as, in a one financial year, it will be called as non-performing asset. Why it is called asset? Because a bank has given you loan. So loan is what? Loan is an asset for the bank. Why? Because they have this hope that they are going to get it back. That is why it has been named as, or it is kept in asset list, okay, not in the liabilities. Liabilities means what? That this is the liability of bank, okay? For example, it means this is this incur expenses, but these loans, these are not liability of bank, these are assets, because anyhow in any of the years they are going to get this amount back along with interest rate. Okay, that is what is called asset. So this converts into non-performing asset. Non-performing, it means in one financial year, this loan what bank has given to you, this has not given any profit to bank. Okay, so ye kya ho gaya? NPA ho gaya. Gross NPA kya hua? The total NPA of any bank. For example, SBI had given loans to too many persons, like 200 persons it has given loan in a year. So gross NPA is what? It means out of 200, 100 people have not paid their bank, paid their loan back. So gross NPA will be the total NPA of all such 100 customers. This is called gross. ठीक है तो वो ज्यादा ही होगा. बैड लोन क्या हुआ? बैड लोन एक इंडिविजुअल का हुआ, फिर वो इंडिविजुअल का एनपीए हुआ. ग्रॉस एनपीए सबका टोटल कर दो. ठीक है, दीनदयाल, चल. सो फर्स्ट इज व्हाट? First is, at less than 6%, overall rate of credit growth is equal. That was quite dismal. And that is particularly worrisome is the negligible growth in wholesale credit. Okay. Wholesale credit, that refers to loans that was worth 500 crores or more. Rate of growth for retail loans. Okay. Retail loans means the loan to individuals, that includes housing loans, consumption loans, any loan given to any consumer. For example, you have taken loan for housing, you have taken loan for your automobile or your vehicle loans, any loan, okay, what an individual takes. So that had that had become much better in comparison. So performance of retail loan, it has found it was better. Comparatively. Thirdly, looking that was obvious how sharp fall in credit growth happened much before the COVID pandemic hit India. The considerable weakness in demand before pandemic, that suggests the recovery in the credit growth may take longer than usual, because the Indian economy had lost its growth momentum long before COVID-19. It means it is not about COVID-19. The sole reason is not COVID-19. We have lacked in the demand, okay, in the increase of demand before struck of COVID-19. It means the problem had started before COVID-19. Okay, that is why demand had been shrunken. Credit growth had been fallen. So beyond data crunching, Financial Stability Report also published the result of the latest round, that was of April 2021, of the systemic risk survey that looks ahead and tries to capture the perception of experts that include market participants or major risks faced by the Indian financial system. So risks are broadly classified into 5 categories. These are global, macroeconomic, financial market, institutional, and general. So while overall risk perception is medium, and there were several factors on which experts have expected a bleaker picture than the one provided in January Financial Stability Report. Possibly because of this systemic risk survey, which has been done in April, when second wave was already there in the country. So as regards immediate impact of second COVID wave on the economy, that gave a large percentage of respondents expected employment, productivity, wages to decline, even as they expect prices to rise. It means it has impacted employment ratio. It has impacted our productivity. Second wave, why? Because the same situation had repeated during second wave of COVID-19. So, but despite of all such things, what we have faced, increase in the price of commodity, inflation had increased. That was the issue, what Indian economy had faced. So that was about Financial Stability Report published by RBI recently at the end of the June Okay, first FSR had been released by RBI, so it has assessed the financial functioning of India in those 6 months. So that is all about this article. Moving on to the next one. Now, crafting a unique partnership with Africa, the future of India-Africa cooperation is agriculture, even as the China factor looms large. Basically, India and Africa, if we talk about, you can see the location, African continent, lots of countries are there. India, okay, so India and Africa, 52 nations of Africa, we used to have India-Africa summit. Okay, 52 nations of Africa, they used to take part in the India-Africa summit. So there are lots of avenues for India, which it can search in Africa. But basically the article which is talking about that India should focus on the agriculture, cooperation in agriculture with African countries. Along with this, India also need to work so that influence of China on Africa can be minimized, can be declined. Why? Because China, we know, its assertion is increasing. It is asserting in Africa, and it is providing the same theory. It is repeating. It is providing loans for the for the infrastructure development. It is providing loans. It is establishing its manufacturing hubs, manufacturing units. So availability of cheap labor, availability of natural resources, so exploitation of resources can be done by China. So it is having its own intention. But if we see India, so India can establish its good relations with African countries, and that will be on the basis of cooperation. It means both the countries will cooperate with each other. They will work together. They will not assert like China, what China is doing. Okay, so lots of avenues are there, and especially agriculture is still, it is void, okay, which India can fill. So context of this article is that a historical solidarity is today a modern partnership. That has been tweeted by our external affairs minister during his recent trip to Kenya. So critical to its foreign policy matrix, India's engagement with African continent has been multifaceted, with projects implemented under Indian lines of credit, capacity building initiatives, cooperation in the range of sectors. As an importer of fruits, nuts, grains, and pulses from the continent, Indian congruence with African countries in the agriculture sector is expanding. With 65% of the world's uncultivated arable land, employing over 60% of the workforce, and accounting for almost 20% of the sub-Saharan Africa's GDP, agriculture is critical to Africa's economy. An African Continental Free Trade Agreement, Free Trade Area Agreement, is expected to improve cost competitiveness by removing tariffs. So as this relationship enters post-pandemic world, it is vital to prioritize the channel resources into augmenting partnership in the agriculture. And this is crucial given its unexplored potential, centrality to global food security, business prospects, and to provide credible alternatives to the increasing involvement of Chinese stakeholders in the sector. It means if India and Africa will cooperate in those areas where there is chances, okay, like agriculture, they can expand agriculture in sub-Saharan Africa, okay, which is where agriculture is critical to Africa's economy. So here India has chances, and here by doing these ways, another thing is free trade agreement. So by removing tariffs, competitiveness will increase, okay, economic or trade relationship will be established. So by doing this, what they can do, control the increasing involvement of Chinese stakeholders in Africa, in different sectors in Africa. Okay. So evaluating the approaches that Chinese corporations, small and medium-sized enterprises, and entrepreneurs adopt has provided a layered perspective in the socio-political, economic, and environmental impact of Chinese engagement. Basically, China has intention to involve in Africa, okay, through different ways. Socio-politically, economically, environmentally, okay, lots of impacts are there because of Chinese engagement, because they have this intention to establish their manufacturing units, whether of electronics, whether of different sectors, okay. So it may have different impacts, okay, lots of impacts on Africa. So today China is among Africa's largest trading partners, and it is also Africa's single biggest creditor. Now see, this is a game basically. China is biggest creditor to Africa. It is biggest trading partner of Africa, and its corporations dominate the region's infrastructure market and are now entering the agri-infra sector. So increasingly critical to China's global aspirations is its engagement in African agriculture is taking on a strategic quality. And dismissing Beijing's engagement in African agriculture is inconsequential for India would be unwise. So while access to Africa's natural resources, its untapped markets and support for One China policy are primary drivers of Chinese engagement with the region, and there are other factors at play. So basically, China had adopted One China policy in Africa. Africa is also supporting One China policy. Okay, it means only China will trade. Okay, so monopoly of China can be seen. So Africa's natural resources, basically China is keeping its eye on that. Okay, cheap labor is available in Africa, as we know. So China, poverty is already there. So Chinese built industrial parks, economic zones in Africa are attracting low cost, labor intensive manufacturing units that are relocating from China. So Chinese engineers, they are interviewed and they spoke of how their operations in Africa are important to accumulate global experience in management, risk and capital investments. Not only are they willing to overlook short-term profits in order to build brand China, but they want to dominate the market in the long term. That includes pushing Chinese standards in host countries. So Chinese tech companies, they are laying critical telecommunications infrastructure. Venture capital funds are investing in the African fintech firms, and with other smaller enterprises are also expanding across the region. Many Chinese entities, they have been active in Africa's agricultural landscape for decades now. And the nature, form and actors that involved have undergone substantial changes. Zambia. That is one of the countries of Africa. So here Chinese firms have introduced agri-tech to combat traditional challenges, like using drone technology to control the fall armyworm infestation. So basically in Zambia, armyworm, that is one of the worm which may impact the production of crop production. So here, to tackle the issue of armyworm, what China had done, China had installed drone technology. Okay, it has used drone technology to capture the data of armyworm, and it can save the production crops, crop production. So they have set over 20 agricultural technological demonstration centers in the continent where Chinese agronomists work on developing new crop varieties and increasing crop yields. It means genetic modifications of crops are also being taken place in Africa, which has been established by China. These agriculture technology demonstration centers, they are partnered with local universities. They conduct workshops, classes for officials, provide training and lease equipment to smallholder farmers. So Chinese companies with no prior experience in agriculture, they have set out to build futuristic ecological parks, while others are purchasing large-scale commercial farms. So here they have entered in the agriculture without any experience, without any knowledge. With the help of technology, they are doing it. And other sectors are also being occupied, are also being taken up by China, that is commercial farms. So furthermore, African agriculture experts, officials and farmers are provided opportunities to augment skills and be trained in China. So exponential growth in China-Africa economies, ties and emergence of Beijing as an alternate to traditional Western powers has motivated change in perceptions across groups. Governments and heads of states are recalibrating approaches. Media houses are investing more resources for on-the-ground reporting. And artists like Michael Soy in Kenya are using satirical paintings to start a dialogue. Simultaneously, Africa-China relations are becoming complex with a growing insular diaspora, lopsided trade, looming debt, competition with local businesses, and a negative perception accompanied by greater political and socio-economic interlinkages. So these are those issues which Africa is facing because of China's, because of their relationship with China. So examining Chinese interactions also provides cues on what not to do. Okay, so Chinese and African experts, they are working on the agriculture trade, what was the full form? Agriculture Technology Demonstration Centers that seemingly operate in silos. Okay, and occasionally there seems to be a gap between skills transferred in China and the ground realities in Africa. It means China had built a technology. So this technology, basically it is not working on the ground issues, what Africa is facing. So there is a gap. And in some cases, technology taught in China is not available locally and in others. And there is inability to implement lessons learned due to the absence of supporting resources. So larger commercial farms, which is run by Mandarin-speaking managers and presence of small-scale business farmers in local markets, they have aggravated socio-cultural stresses because the officials, they doesn't know the language, they doesn't understand the local language. Locals, they doesn't understand Chinese language. So because of this, socio-cultural stress has increased. Okay. So if we talk about India-Africa cooperation, then what are those avenues? So India-Africa agriculture cooperation, currently it includes institutional and individual capacity building initiatives like India-Africa Institute of Agriculture and Rural Development in Malawi, extension of soft loans, supply of machineries, acquisition of farmlands, presence of Indian entrepreneurs in the African agricultural ecosystem, okay, that India can do. And Indian farmers, they have purchased over 6 lakh hectares of land for commercial farming in Africa. Subnational actors are also providing another model of cooperation in agriculture. Considering the case of the Kerala government, they are trying to meet its steep requirement for raw cashew nuts, which is amounting to 8 lakh tons a year with imports from countries in Africa to complement its production capacity currently, which is limited to 0.83 lakh tons. So if Kerala and Africa, they start working, they work together on the cashew production. So for that, they can fulfill the demands of each other. So there are also proposals to create jointly owned brand of Africa Kolam cashews. Okay, similar ideas could also encourage state governments and civil society organization to identify opportunities and invest directly. There is also promise in incentivizing Indian industries to tap into African agribusinesses, value chains, connecting Indian technology firms, startups with partners in Africa. So basically India is also lacking, okay, in these sectors. But India can help Africa. They can establish their relations in agribusinesses, and together they can earn profits. Okay, so transformative power of innovative and disruptive technology has been evident in the African agri-tech sectors as the startup ecosystem in the continent, which is enjoying a 110% growth between 2016 and 2018. So in the past years, despite the pandemic, sector witnessed a record increase in investments. Thorough impact assessment, which is required to be conducted of the existing capacity building initiatives in agriculture for India to stand in good stead. This could include detailed surveys of participants who have returned to their home countries. Country-specific and localized curriculum can be drawn up that makes skill development demand-led. India's Africa strategy exists independently, and it is important to be cognizant of China's increasing footprint in the region. So China's model, if we see, if it gets successful in Africa, so that could be heralded as a replica for the larger global South. And it is important to note here that prominent African voices have emphasized that their own agency is often overlooked in global discourse on the subject. And in this sense, India has consistently chosen well to underline the development partnership to be in line with African priorities. And it is also pertinent that we can collectively craft a unique model partnership with Africa. It means when Africa established its relations with China, it has impacted the lives of the people. We have discussed about the technology, lacking in the technology, the language issue, cultural issue, socio-cultural issue, socio-economic issue, environmental issues, lots of issues Africa is facing because of China's assertion. So India basically can become an alternative and a good alternative, okay, which Africa wants, which India wants. And so here basically they can collectively they can craft unique modern partnership, okay, with each other. So that is all about this article. Moving on to the next one. Will a national judiciary work? In the current context, the feasibility of all India judicial service requires to be studied. Basically, this article is talking about regarding establishment of all India judicial services. Okay, all India services, basically. So judicial services, basically, this is not new. This issue, this discussion is not new. it used to be discussed in the past. It has started in the past. And in fact, NJ, that was about collegium. That is something else. Basically, the way what UPSC conducts examination for selection of collectors, selection of IPS, IAS, IFS. So this is what, this is All India Services. It means a uniform exam is taken by UPSC, and all such candidates who get selected by UPSC, they will serve at All India level. Okay, it means a Bihari candidate, a Bihari officer can be deployed in Kerala. A Keralite can be deployed in northeastern states. So this is what, this is All India Services. So this All India Services, basically it judges people, it examines people on the basis of their knowledge, what they have gained throughout their studies. So similarly, in judicial services, where lots of lackings can be found, lack of manpower, lack of knowledge, lack of curriculum, lots of things are there. We'll discuss about that. So just to mitigate these issues, what had been suggested, there is a requirement regarding establishment of All India Judicial Services. Okay. So context is that Union government appears to be steadfast in it, in its resolve to implement reforms in recruitment and appointment to the subordinate judicial services. Basically, if you see judicial services examination that occurs in our country, but it is state specific. Bihar having its own judicial services, Kerala having its own judicial services, Tamil Nadu having its own, northeastern states having its own, okay, wherever judiciaries are there. So basically these judicial services, they are regarding appointment of subordinate judiciary. Okay, so in 2019, it spearheaded a consultative process for the creation of All India Judicial Services. Initially, only 4 states and 2 high courts supported this proposal. 8 states rejected. 5 suggested changes, 11 yet to respond. So recently, Centre took the ordinance route to effect changes in the appointment of members of the various tribunals. In a single stroke, it abolished several tribunals. Manner of appointment of members to the remaining tribunals underwent a sea change. And it is likely that the ordinance may not pass judicial scrutiny in the light of Supreme Court's judgment in Roger Matthew versus South Indian Bank, 2019. So Article 233, Clause 1 of the Constitution, that laid down that appointments of a person to be and the posting and promotion of district judges in any state shall be made by the governor of the state in consultation with the High Court exercising jurisdiction in relation to such state. For example, two or more states or one or more states can have one High Court. Okay, so in that situation, what can be done? As per Article 233, this is constitutional provision that appointment, posting and promotion of any district judge that is made by the governor of the state after consulting High Court. Okay, so whether this is High Court of one state or one or more states. So 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act in 1976 amended Article 312. Clause 1, that gives power to the parliament to make laws for the creation of one or more All India Services. Article 312, this is the upper hand of Rajya Sabha basically. Rajya Sabha can analyze the situation where All India Services can be created. So 42nd Amendment Act made some changes in this article, which gives power to the parliament to make law for the creation of one or more All India Services, including AIJS, All India Judicial Services, which is common to the union and states. Okay. Clause 3 of Article 312 that places a restrictions that such a service shall not include a post inferior to that of a district judge. Okay. It means under Clause 3 of the Article 312, a restriction has been given. And all such rights, whatever had been given in the Constitution, there are restrictive rights are there. So restriction in clause 3rd has been given that services shall not include post inferior to district judge. So amendment also brought about a significant change in the 7th schedule. Entry 3 of the list 2 in its entirety was placed as entry 11A in the list 3rd. So that has paved the way for the parliament to enact laws with the regard to the administration of justice, constitution, and organization of all the courts except Supreme Court and High Court. It means parliament had got the power, Okay, as per 42nd changes done by the 42nd Amendment Act. So Parliament got the power to enact law regarding administration of justice, constitution, and organization of all the courts in different states. Okay, but they cannot establish more than one high court in one state, and they also cannot establish a Supreme Court, more than one Supreme Court. So there is one Supreme Court for entire country, apex court, and high courts, whatever has been established for all such states and UTs. So post-emergency amendment to Article 312 Clause 1 has escaped parliamentary scrutiny. What has been taken place during 42nd Amendment Act? So it has not been scrutinized by Parliament. A dichotomy exists with the regard to Article 233 and 312. What was essentially intended to be the prerogative of the state will now be the prerogative of the union. A fundamental power of the state to make such rules and govern the appointment of district judges is taken away. It may be against the principle of federalism and the basic structure doctrine. Okay, this is what basic structure. So it has not been defined, but if it has found that fundamental power of the state to make such rules and governing the appointment of district judge, if it is taken away from the state, then it will be against the principle of federalism, because federalism is what? Relationship between center and state. So it will against the principle of federalism, and federalism is one of the basic structures. Okay. So first law commission deliberated upon this, but it was only in 1972 that issue had gained momentum. The views of Chief Justice of India and Law Commission reports, it paved the way to bring in the 42nd Constitutional Amendment. And in 1986, Law Commission resurrected the issue and deliberated upon the objections. So primary fear was that promotional avenues of the subordinate judiciary would be severely curtailed. 50% of the post of district judges are to be filled by promotion from the subordinate judicial services, and that leaving open the remaining for direct recruitment. It means 50% of district judges, post of district judges, that will be fulfilled by promotion of the subordinate judicial services. Okay, and rest of the 50% that have to be filled by direct recruitment. And remember clause 3 of Article 312, that lesser than district judge post, there should be no appointment under All India Services. It means subordinate judiciary does not come under All India Services as per 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act. So another fundamental concern was language barrier. So first is what? That 50% by promotion of subordinate judges, and 50% of district judge post, that has to be fulfilled by direct recruitment. Next to next issue is language barrier to implement All India Judicial Services. Okay, so Union Law Minister has extolled All India Judicial Services to be an ideal solution for equal representation of the marginalized and deprived section of the society. Most states already have reservation policy in force. Tamil Nadu has provided for a roster-based reservation of 69%, of which 30% is for women. UP, it provides merely 20% reservation for women, and All India Judicial Services, it benefits states like UP. Okay, so arguments that All India Judicial Services will reduce judicial delays do not hold water, as the subordinate courts are the crucial point of delaying owing to the existence of the large vacancies. So because of large vacancies are void, okay, it is still unfulfilled. So because of that, pending of or delays in the justice can be seen at the subordinate level. So in the early 1960s, the issue was debated during Chief Justice's conference, and it was favored by eminent body, but many states and high courts had opposed it. So first National Judicial Pay Commission found that it would be in the interest and health of the judiciary to form an All India Judicial Services. And in the All India Judges case in 1992, Apex Court had opined that the recommendations of the Law Commission should be examined and implemented for the creation of All India Judicial Services. So issue was again discussed in the All India Judges Association versus Union of India in 2002. And court has accepted most recommendations of the Shetty Commission and directed the government to implement the judgment. So any groundbreaking reform is bound to receive criticism. National Commission constituted for review of the constitution, which was headed by luminaries, including Justice H.R. Khanna, J.P., Justice B.P. Jeevan Reddy, K. Prasaram, Attorney General, he was by that time. So they suggested a paradigm shift in the approach of the union. And feasibility of All India Judicial Service in the current context required to be studied, especially when reliance is placed upon archaic reports of the Law Commission. So when we are relying on the Law Commission report, then there is need to study the situation before implementation of All India Judicial Services. So it is for the union to dispel doubts and at the same time give wings to the aspirations of the stakeholders when implementing the proposal. And however, it remains to be seen if All India Judicial Services would be like the proverbial curate's egg. Okay. So the crux of this article is before implementation. So All India Judicial Services, as we got to know that this is not new debate. It has started since Indira Gandhi government, okay, establishment of All India Judicial Services. So some changes had been occurred. And it has been said that there are lots of barriers in the implementation of All India Judicial Services. So before implementation and relying upon Law Commission report, it is required to study the current context, to study the current situation. Okay, then only it can be done. So that is all about this article. Moving on to the next one. Fresh stirrings on the federalism as new politics. Abhi to discuss kiya beta, Dindyal. क्या क्या प्रॉब्लम है अच्छा आप बताओ इफ ऑल इंडिया जुडिशियल सर्विसेज विल गेट इंप्लीमेंटेड देन व्हाट माइट बी द प्रॉब्लम्स व्हाई पॉलिटिशियंस दे आर नॉट एबल टू और फेडरलिज्म इशू कैसे हाउ ये तो फेडरलिज्म को और प्रमोट करेगा ना इफ ऑल इंडिया जुडिशियल सर्विसेज वुड बी देयर बेसिकली व्हाट आई हैव अंडरस्टूड What is my opinion on this? Why states are against implementation of this All India Judicial Services? First thing that politically or what say by changing some amendments or by changing some provisions in the constitution, it has put restriction to implement this All India Judicial Services that below district judge post, it cannot be done for the subordinate services. ठीक है तो वहाँ पे constitution में ही change कर दिया. Second thing is that what I believe, what is my opinion on this? It is nothing, just a political chaos. Nothing else, just a political chaos. States are saying that there might be language issue, but there is no language issue while going for UPSC examination, while going for other All India Service examination. Then why they always put barrier of language? Why they always raise barrier of language while implementing All India Judicial Services? ठीक है सो बेसिकली दे से दैट देयर इज लैंग्वेज इशू इफ ऑल इंडिया जुडिशियल सर्विसेज वुड बी इंप्लीमेंटेड देन केरलाइट वुड नॉट गो एंड ही वुड नॉट बी एबल टू सर्व इन बिहार ही वुड नॉट बी एबल टू सर्व इन यूपी सो नॉर्थ ईस्टर्न स्टेट सॉरी नॉर्दर्न स्टेट्स एंड सदर्न स्टेट देयर इज अ ग्रेट डिवाइड इन द कल्चर इन द सोसाइटी ठीक है सो इट इज नॉट फिजिबल बिकॉज ऑल इंडिया जुडिशियल सर्विसेज इफ वी टॉक अबाउट सो दिस इज रिगार्डिंग जस्टिस ठीक है to provide justice to the people whom you will give justice you will give justice justice to the people there are lots of issues and at subordinate level what kind of issues you get to hear like family issues like property related issues these are those issues what people face at the ground level in the subordinate judiciary hai na yahi to hota hai marriage related issues family dispute property disputes these are those of the issues so basically there might be different rules regarding marriage regarding property regarding households in South India and if South Indian judge will get posted in North India then obviously he will not be able to understand the exact rules of the society then he might not be able to provide good jurisdiction theek hai so these are some of the reasons basically behind non-implementation of All India or problems behind judicial services. They are doing it. They have their own recruitment process. You might have seen that All India, judicial services examination of state level. Kerala ka apna hai, Tamil Nadu ka apna hai, Karnataka ka apna hai, Northern states ka apna hai, Bihar, Delhi. They have their own judicial services. Why? Because those subordinate officers, they will work in their own state only. Why? Because they are familiar with the situation of their own state. Okay. So I believe this is nothing, just a political chaos, nothing else. ऐसा नहीं है कि इशू को रिजॉल्व नहीं किया जा सकता. दे कैन रिजॉल्व दिस इशू. दे कैन सीरियसली रिजॉल्व दिस इशू. दिस इज नॉट अ बिग प्रॉब्लम. ठीक है. चलो. नाउ नेक्स्ट आर्टिकल रिगार्डिंग फेडरलिज्म. सो फ्रेश स्टरिंग्स ऑन द फेडरलिज्म फेडरलिज्म एज अ न्यू पॉलिटिक्स. सो देयर आर फैक्टर्स व्हिच इफ हार्नेस्ड वेल दैट कैन क्रिएट अ पॉलिटिकल मोमेंट फॉर अ प्रिंसिपल्ड पॉलिटिक्स ऑफ फेडरलिज्म. सो दिस आर्टिकल बेसिकली डिफरेंट एरियाज हैड बीन डिस्कस्ड रिगार्डिंग फेडरलिज्म. व्हाट इश्यूज आर दे विल टॉक अबाउट. सो बेसिकली जीएसटी, इंप्लीमेंटेशन ऑफ जीएसटी, देन नीति आयोग है ना, वैक्सीनेशन. सो दीज आर व्हाट, दीज आर सम ऑफ द की इंडिकेटर्स और की पिलर्स ऑफ फेडरलिज्म, कोऑपरेटिव फेडरलिज्म. ठीक है. सो बिटवीन वैक्सीन वॉर्स दैट हीटेड डिबेट्स ओवर जीएसटी, पर्सनल बैटल्स लाइक फ्रेकर्स ओवर वेस्ट बंगाल चीफ सेक्रेटरी एंड पुश बैक अगेंस्ट कॉन्ट्रोवर्शियल रेगुलेशन इन लक्षद्वीप, इज इंडिया रेडी फॉर अ न्यू फेडरल बार्गेन? दिस क्वेश्चन हैज बीन रेज्ड. ठीक है. बेसिकली देर हैड बीन फाउंड फेडरलिज्म इशू इन लक्षद्वीप एज वेल, है ना. वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द न्यू व्हाट्स ए लैंड डेवलपमेंट अथॉरिटी रेगुलेशन. सो दैट वाज व्हाट, देयर वाज अ इशू ऑफ फेडरलिज्म दैट पीपल डजंट वांट. दिस इज अ यूनियन टेरिटरी बट इट्स इम्प्लीमेंटेशन ऑफ ऑल सच व्हाट्स ए इम्प्लीमेंटेशन ऑफ ऑल सच ड्राफ्ट दैट क्रिएट्स अ फेडरलिज्म इशू. ठीक है. सो एम्बोल्डन्ड बाय विक्ट्रीज इन द रीसेंट स्टेट असेंबली इलेक्शंस, द आइडिया ऑफ अ थर्ड फेडरल फ्रंट इज वंस अगेन गेनिंग पॉलिटिकल कैशे, एज वाज एविडेंट इन द शरद पवार ऑर्गेनाइज्ड ओपोजिशन मीट. डीएमके आफ्टर टेकिंग ऑफिस, दे बिगन टू क्राफ्ट एन आइडियोलॉजिकल नैरेटिव ऑन द स्टेट राइट्स एंड दे रीइंट्रोड्यूस द टर्म यूनियन इनटू द पब्लिक डिस्कोर्स एंड पुशिंग बैक अगेंस्ट इंक्रीज्ड फिस्कल सेंट्रलाइजेशन. Whether it has renewed emphasis on federalism, that is a genuine opportunity for forging a new politics. Basically, federalism, what government or what political parties do, basically they use federalism word to show their political enthusiasm, to impose their political enthusiasm. So in the name of politics, in the name of their political enthusiasm, they always emphasize on federalism. They always use this term federalism, that there is if it is not get implemented as per the state wish, then there might be problem in the federalism. So federalism in India, that always add political relevance, but except for the States Reorganization Act, federalism has rarely been an axis of political mobilization. So it was true even during the days of coalition politics, when state politics had mattered to national electoral outcomes. Fiscal and administrative centralization had persisted despite nearly two decades of coalition government. And rather than deepening federalism, the contingencies of electoral politics have created significant impediments to create a political consensus for the genuine federalism. So when confronted with the entrenchment of the centralization of present regime, the challenge is bigger, okay, in the implementation of federalism. So first is what, the rhetoric of nationalism that has greater political purchase. Ideologically, the present government has relatively little patience with federalism as a device to accommodate India's multiple linguistic, religious, and ethnic identities. Basically, what we are seeing during present government, lots of changes are being taken place without knowing the issues, ground realities. Okay, for example, abrogation of 370. I'm not against of it. I'm just giving an example. Okay. So if abrogation of 370 had been taken place, so what was the will of the state? That happened against the will of the state. Okay. So here what they are saying, what the writer is saying, that relatively BJP had little patience with federalism, and they have used it as a device to accommodate India's multiple linguistic, religious, and ethnic identities. So after 2014, BJP has couched its discomfiture with federalism in the grammar of development and nationalism. Okay. It means they have used federalism in the place of development and nationalism. That was its mass electoral appeal. So to accelerate progress, India must become one nation, one market, one nation, one ration card, one nation, one grid. That has been propounded by present government. So in this framing, federalism as a principal necessary for negotiating diverse political context and identity claims risk being equated with regionalism and narrow parochialism that is anti-development and anti-national. So a politics for deepening federalism will require to overcome nationalistic rhetoric that pits federalism against nationalism and development. So here there need to be a separation between federalism and nationalism and development. Okay. So this is a hard ask, especially in the context where most regional parties have failed to uphold their principle of decentralization in their own backyard. Secondly, despite a rhetorical commitment to federalism, politics of federalism has remained contingent rather than principled. So as Pratap Bhanu Mehta has pointed over the decades, that federal principles have been bent in all the kinds of ways to co-produce a political culture of flexible federalism, that is, federalism for me, but not for thee. Okay? So federalism in this rendition is reducing to a game of political upmanship. It means it has only become a political tool. And it remains restricted to the partisan tussle rather than a region's genuine demand for accommodation. So it is only political tussle. There is no region's genuine demand to accommodate with each other. So especially when Clement of greater federalism often maintains silence on unilateral decisions that affect other states. For instance, downgrading of full-fledged state of Jammu and Kashmir into union territory in 2019. And recently, NCT of Delhi changes, whatever had been taken place, that every decision will be taken in the name of Governor LG. Okay. So this blatant undermining of states' rights hardly witnessed protest by parties that were not directly affected by these. And upholding federalism requires political maturity and a commitment to the federal principles, which is lacking in our politics. As per the writer, it has been said. Thirdly, increased economic and governance divergence between states. We are seeing since last year that GST, which had been promoted in the name of cooperative federalism, that states will cooperate with each other in the growth, economic growth. But what happened? What is happening? The cooperative federalism in the name of GST, that has been hampered. Why? Because it is not cooperating. Center is not cooperating with the states. They are saying that because of mercy of the God, it has been, act of the God, it has been, GST had fallen and states will not get compensation. So it will hamper federalism. Okay. So economic trajectories since liberalization have been characterized by growing spatial divergence. And across all the key indicators, southern and western states have outperformed much of the northern and eastern states. So it resulted into greater divergence rather than expected convergence with growth. It means after liberalization, in fact, not even liberalization, before liberalization, if you go, Green Revolution, if I talk about what happened, Punjab, Haryana, Western UP, these states, basically these parts of the states, they benefited because of Green Revolution. What about Eastern states? What about Southern states? Okay, it has not been implemented over there. And because of this, what happened? An economic divide can be seen in the Western and Eastern states. Similarly, in after liberalization, when industries started taking place, industries got its establishment. Various new industries had got established. Gujarat, Maharashtra. Okay, so these Western and Southern states, in fact, so they got new industrial setup. But the same you would not see in the eastern and northern states. So that created a context where collective actions among states becomes difficult as poorer regions of India contribute far less to the economy, but require greater fiscal resources to overcome their economic fragilities. It means like Bihar, Bimaru state, you might have heard of it. Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, UP, these are called Bimaru states. These are dependent on the central taxes. These are dependent on the central finances, fiscal resources. They are not able to generate their own resources. Okay. So these type of states who are not earning well, they are basically economically fragile. And they are dependent heavily on the fiscal support of the center. So they become a burden on the center. So glimpses of these emerging tensions were visible in the debates around 15th Finance Commission when Government of India mandated the commission of the use of 2011 census rather than the established price of using the 1971 census to determine revenue share across the states. Okay. So revenue sharing had been done on the basis of 1971 census. But just now see, 1971 and 2011, lots of changes had been taking place in the society. Population has increased. So resources to the state, so state population has also been increased. So resources should be given to the states as per 2011 census, not as per 1971 census. So this southern states had feared, risked their penalizing states that had successfully controlled population growth by reducing their share in the overall resource pool. 15th Finance Commission, through its recommendation, definitely avoided a political crisis, but the growing divergence between richer and poorer states remain an important source of tension in the interstate relations that can become a real impediment to collective action among states. Then the impending delimitation exercise due in 2026, these tensions will only increase. Delimitation process, if we talk about. We know that in 2026 is the year when delimitation process has to be taken. Why? Because delimitation, basically, it divides constituencies on the basis of population. We know that population has increased. We used to be 125 crore people. Now we are 130 crore people. So every constituency that got divided on the basis of population, okay? On 1 million population, there is one constituency. That is done by delimitation process. So 2026, there are delimitation process is due, okay? And after this, what will happen? States will get new constituencies. It means population has increased in the states. It means states will require more resources. Okay. So these challenges, notwithstanding, BJP's impatience with the federalism affords an opportunity for the regional parties to craft new federal bargain. At one level, BJP's homogenizing ideological project risk creating new forms of cultural alienation and associated regional tensions are occurred during Citizenship Amendment Act when we saw protests in Assam. So there is very real possibility of the emergence of new form of regional sub-nationalism, glimpses of which had been seen during recent assembly elections, particularly in West Bengal. Sub-nationalism had been created in the name of regionalism. Okay. So moreover, the realities of India's macro-fiscal position risk increasing the fragility of state finances, and weak fiscal management has brought union government on the brink of what economist Ratin Roy has called a silent fiscal crisis. What is the silent fiscal crisis? That dependence of the state is increasing. Those states who are not performing well. So if fiscal management would not be brought by union government, then what will happen? A silent fiscal crisis can be seen. So union's response has been a squeeze revenue from states by increasing their cesses, its insistence on giving GST compensation to state as loan after long delays and increasing state share in the central schemes. So the pandemic-induced economic crisis has only aggravated this. Achha, what happened when compensation issue was there between between center and states regarding GST? What it has been said by the council, that state are open to take loan from external market. What is this? Okay, this is against federalism. So union response had squeezed revenue from states by increasing cesses. Cesses has been increased. It was said that GST will subsume all such cesses, all such indirect taxes. One nation, one tax would be there. But lots of new cesses has been increased. And these cesses, basically, it goes to central government, not to the state government. So it has reduced state's revenue. Okay. So pandemic-induced economic crisis has only aggravated the issue of federalism. And against this backdrop, it harnessed well both sub-nationalist sentiments and the need to reclaim fiscal federalism that create a political moment for a principled politics of the federalism. So there are risks along the way, like Suhas Palshikar has argued that politics of regional identity is isolationist by its very nature. An effort at collective political action for federalism is based on the identity concern will have to overcome this risk. And on the fiscal side, richer state must find a way to share the burden with the poorer states. It means if richer states have resources, they should share the burden of poorer state by providing those resources or share of those resources. So state will have to show political maturity to make necessary compromises if they are to negotiate existing tensions and win the collective battle with the union. An interstate platform that brings states together in a routine dialogue on matters of fiscal federalism could be the starting point for building trust and a common agenda. The seeds of this had been planted in the debates over 15th Finance Commission and implementation of GST. And finally, beyond the principles, a renewed politics of federalism is also an electoral necessity. No coalition had succeeded in the long term without a glue that binds it. Forging a political consensus on federalism that can be that glue. In a coalition government, wherever we have seen, so coalition does not go for long. What can bind it? Federalism can bind it. Okay. So, but this would require immense patience and maturity from regional parties. So that is all about this article. I hope it is clear. Moving on to the next one. Seeking a paradigm shift in mental health care, WHO's guidance on community mental health services balances care and support with rights and participation. Basically, mental health. This is also one of the silent pandemic. Why it is silent pandemic? These days, you can see people at different stages of their life. They are tackling with the issues of mental problem, whether it is acute, whether it is higher depression, mental issues, overthinking, desires are increasing. Lots of issues are there. So it is, we are moving towards a silent pandemic in the name of mental health. Okay, deteriorating mental health. So here this article, the context of this article is that recently High Court has suggested that homeless persons with health conditions be branded with a permanent tattoo when vaccinated against COVID-19, since tracking a floating population may be cumbersome. Earlier judgments have also suggested roundups for such persons to facilitate pathways into care. And these are possible well-intentioned directives, but what follows is that bewildered persons are huddled in a vehicle and admitted into shelters or mental hospitals that are usually crowded and they are lonely. So what does this tell about the way homelessness and mental illness are regarded in the polite society? So persons with mental health conditions, they need responsive care system that inspire hope and participation without which their lives are empty. Many countries where persons with severe mental health conditions, they are living in shackles in their homes, in overcrowded hospitals, and even in the prisons. On the other hand, many persons with mental health issues, they live and even die alone on the streets. We have seen many of the instances. Three losses dominate the mental health system, that is dignity, agency, and personhood. Far-sighted changes in the policy and laws that have not often taken root, and many laws fail to meet international human rights standards. What are those? So many also do not account for cultural, social, and political contexts that result in moral rhetoric that doesn't change the scenario of inadequate care. Society's response that often based on the conditioning and perceptions, and often it verge on the visceral form of prejudice. It may result in an othering of persons who seem different from dominant groups, and well-intentioned judgment could set off unintended negative, even grave consequences as well. So there is also social legacy of the asylum and of the psychiatry and mental illness itself that guide our imagination in how care is organized. Similarly, historian Sarah Ann Pinto, she says in her account of lunatic asylums in Colonial Bombay. He wrote that doctors interpreted a patient's refusal to wear clothing as a sign of morbidity, and clothing became a way of civilizing the savage, the violent Indian man, and the promiscuous Indian women. So individual preferences and indigenous culture were substituted with what the colonizer thought was appropriate. Similarly, medieval London had boasted of a hospital for the care of the persons with mental illness, and St. Mary of Bethlehem, that soon turned into a bedlam. That was a poor house and a site of shocking atrocities. So guidance had been issued by WHO. What are those? So here we need to understand mental health conditions. reasons for what they are and for how they are associated with the disadvantages. So these situations are linked, but not always. So therefore, not all distress can be medicalized. It means every distress is not mental issue, mental problem. So it is against this complex background of distress arising out of medical conditions and from inequitable social system of good intentions and calamitous consequences that we welcome on the guidance of non-community mental health services, which has recently been launched by World Health Organization. So guidance include three models from India that addresses the issue from the same side as mental health service user and focuses on the co-production of knowledge and on good practices, which is building around the key themes of crisis services, peer support, supported living, community outreach, hospital-based services, comprehensive mental health service networks. So drawn from 22 countries, these models balance care and support with rise in participation. There is Akia House in USA that is driven by peers, and it offers respite to those persons who have significant emotional or mental distress. People here, they can stay for up to seven nights, and here they are connected to networks that support their recovery. Services, so this is peer support. Services are not coercive, and persons can opt to stay or leave based on the discussions with peer supporters. Similarly, there is Tupu Ake, that is a New Zealand-based recovery house services. So here it also welcomes guests from various ethnicities. And Atmiyata, there is in Gujarat, that employs a stepped care approach, which uses community-based volunteers who identify persons in distress. They counsel, they offer their counseling support and enable access to social care benefits to those people. Evaluation of these services indicates better general health, better quality of life, and social functioning. Then Naya Daur in West Bengal, it also works with local networks, volunteers who support homeless persons through their outreach program and enable access to food, clothing, counseling, shelter, and housing. Another program that is Home Again, which is a program of Banyan in Tamil Nadu. They facilitate residence options in regular neighborhoods while also offering graded levels of supportive services for persons with severe disabilities. And they emphasize socio-cultural participation, where neurodiversity and normalization of mental health conditions are been seen. So peer leaders provide wisdom from their lived experience to support others in the distress. Practice of often open dialogue, therapeutic practice that originates in Finland. They run through many programs in the guidelines. And this practice conducted in the homes or in the service settings combines individuals and systemic family therapy with the focus on centrality of relationships and promotion of connectedness through family and support networks. So here, this approach trains the therapist in the de-escalation of distress and breaks power differentials that allow for free expression, aiming at providing newer perspectives to governments and policymakers. Approaches in the new WHO guidelines or guidance are designed to make community inclusion and dialogue practice as a way of life. And with the emphasis on the social care components like workforce participation, pensions and housings, increasing investment in the health and social care system, these are seen as imperative, okay, for the improvement of mental health care system. So services, if we talk about, so recently Supreme Court and Madras High Court, they advised vaccinations for those who are in the mental health care homes and for those who are homeless and living with a mental illness. So those in the institutions should access this support at the earliest, and for those homeless and who opt not to enter mental health establishments en masse, for where exist pathways may be laborious, there are two paths. In the first, drives will be conducted, and persons with mental illness will be housed in the overcrowded institutions with scant regard for agency or for social determinants of ill health. Then other would aim to, so here, what is the first? The first is to conduct the drive, and person who are having a mental illness, they will be housed in the overcrowded institutions. Second is what? Second aim would aim to provide network of services that range from soup kitchens at vantage points to mobile mental health and social care clinics, non-intimidating guest houses at village panchayats with access to toilets, comfort of welcoming team and well-being kiosk that offer a basic income or facilitate livelihoods for them. small emergency care and recovery centers for those who need crisis support instead of larger hospitals, long-term inclusive living options in an environment and that values diversity and celebrates social mixing. So it will reframe the archaic narrative of how mental health care is to be provided. With a strong health system, Tamil Nadu has placed to demonstrate through pilots and an exclusive policy for homeless persons with mental illness that political intent, good governance, creative thinking can solve complex problems and cater to the needs of ultra-vulnerable. Meanwhile, mental health service users whom we met interpreted her tattoo as "We are all one." And if we can learn to be on the same side as the mental health service users, it seems possible that we can learn to respect human diversity. Okay, so this is all about this article. Moving on to the next one. Vacancies send a wrong signal. Leaving top post in the government unoccupied affects governance and it's demoralizing for officers. Basically, this article is talking about the vacant post in the government, big official, government post at the higher level, and its impact in the governance. So context is that vacancies in the central government and states in the recent years have had a deleterious effect on the governance. And for the months on end, top slots in important government agencies remain vacant. Delays in promotions and appointments not only impact the organization, but it also tend to demoralize the officials who are awaiting promotions after vacancies that has increased. So the post of chairman of National Human Rights Commission that was kept vacant until June this year, even though the previous chairman H.L. Dattu had retired in December 2020. Post of director of Central Bureau Investigation, it was also being kept vacant until the recent appointment of Subodh Kumar Jaiswal. Post had been vacant since February after Rishi Kumar Shukla had retired. Then similarly, Chief Election Commissioner, who was Sunil Arora, he got retired on 12th of April amidst an aggressive election campaign and polling in West Bengal and four other states this year, leaving just two members in the commission. One of CEC, basically, it is a three-member body, one Chief Election Commissioner, Commissioner and two election commissioners. So one of them became CEC out of two by virtue of his seniority in the election commission. In case of a disagreement on any issues between the two of them, a solution would have become difficult. Senta appointed Anoop Chandra Pandey as a new election commissioner in June. Meanwhile, Association for Democratic Reforms has filed a public interest litigation in Supreme Court demanding the appointment of chief election commissioners by a committee and is done in the case of appointment of the director of CBI and not by the center, as is the case now. So, Association of Democratic Reforms has referred to the 255th report of Law Commission that had recommended that election commissioners be appointed by a high-powered committee. And high-powered committee headed by Prime Minister has two members, Chief Justice of India and Leader of Opposition in the Lok Sabha. And opposition leader has little say in the selection process. So if Prime Minister decides on a candidate and the CJI consents, then opposition leader's dissenting note carries no weight. And there is a need, therefore, to expand the high-powered committee to include at least two more members of the eminence with proven integrity for the selection process, preferably a retired police officer and a chief minister of a state governed by a party other than that of the party of Prime Minister. So any other party's state chief minister can be part of this high-powered committee as per the Law Commission recommendation. So after Hrishikesh Senapati's retirement in November last year, National Council of Education, Research and Training, NCERT, which is largely responsible for chalking out the education policy of country, is headless. Of 40 central universities across the country, nearly half are without regular vice chancellors. Rakesh Asthana, he assumed additional charges of Narcotic Control Bureau from December 2019. After his appointment as Director General of the Border Security Force in August last, he continued to hold charges of NCB, Narcotics Control Bureau, as DG. Kuldeep Singh, who's DG of Central Reserve Police Force, now also heads the National Investigation Agency after previous incumbent YC Modi, got retired on 31st March last. So impact of such vacancies, what can be? Similar vacancies or examples of officers holding additional charges exist in other ministries as well. commissions and departments, but government appears to turn a blind eye to the malefic effect it has on governance. Vacancies for such long periods tend to paralyze the backbone of these organizations. Appointments to higher echelons can be announced well in time. Delays in important appointments send a wrong signal to the nation. If government can announce its chiefs and vice chiefs a month in advance, there is no reason why this cannot be done in all other ministries and departments. A time frame needs to be worked out to announce top appointments to appointments at least a month in advance, and political considerations need to be pushed to backseat for a clean and honest administration. So if 1 month prior they can have this selection of all such vacant posts, so, but government is not doing so. So what is the reason? So because of this, what is happening? It is impacting the governance system of all such departments. So basically, this is all about this article. Moving on to the next one. Challenging negative social norms. India touches a demographic milestone this World Population Day, but roadblocks remains. Basically, we have, we are second on the population. And a population, data, demographic dividend of country, of India. So if we talk about our demographic dividend is positive. And population terms, we are second after China. So India has touched demographic milestone on World Population Day. But there are certain roadblocks. We'll talk about that. What are roadblocks? Basically, I'm saying demographic dividend. So in the context of demographic dividend, positive demographic dividend, there are many roadblocks. Okay. So what is the context? Context is that in these troubled time of COVID-19, World Population Day on July 11, that brought some positive news. What is that? That India has entered a demographic sweet spot that will continue for another 2 or 3 decades. It means for 20 or 30 years, the sweet spot of demographic will be in favor of India. Half of India's population is under 29 years of age. It means we are workable population, which means that in this period, a great proportion of young people will drive India's economic growth and social progress. So they must not only be healthy, knowledgeable, and skilled, but must also be provided with the rights and choices to develop to their fullest potential, including especially sexual and reproductive health and rights. So Guttmacher, Lancet Commission, that looked at how to improve sexual and reproductive health and rights in populations, that formulated a comprehensive definition for SRHR that encompasses a broader range of issues. That in these includes sexual and reproductive health and rights, issues like violence, stigma, respect for bodily autonomy that greatly impact psychological, emotional, and social well-being of individuals. So India's population growth is now stabilizing, and decline in overall fertility is notwithstanding. The population will continue to grow because of the effect of population momentum. So it is like a jumbo jet that has started to descend, but will take some distance to stop. So total fertility rate presently, it is 2.2 children that soon will replace the level 2.1. And the TFR, that is total fertility rate, remains higher than the national average of 2.2 children among women who live in rural areas, and they have little formal education. They are in the low income quintile. Majority of them live in the poorer states. So changing social norms is one of the biggest challenge for India to address the need of the next generation. Like India's population stabilization strategy must be adjusted, keeping in mind the rights of women and girls. Women must have a greater say in choosing their family size. Prescriptive and coercive methods like 1 or 2 child norms have rarely worked well anywhere for long. It goes without saying that for women and girls, that empowerment to make choices leads to better health outcomes, like knowing how to prevent unintended pregnancy or giving birth with the help of a skilled birth attendant. So women and girls, they need to understand their right. They need to identify their rights. They need to work accordingly as their right. So COVID-19 pandemic had exposed weaknesses in the healthcare system, and it has led to the serious gaps and challenges in the provisions of information and services on sexual and reproductive health in country. Before pandemic, in fact, pervasive negative social norms, health system barriers, gender inequality that had hindered universal access to social, social and reproductive health and rights. So as it was envisioned under program of action of the 1994 International Conference on Population and Development, on World Population Day this year, United Nations Population Fund, in this, India had recognized that even if health systems are understandably strained, the provision of these services cannot wait. And any further delays will curtail the health and well-being of women and girls, the consequences of which can last a lifetime. In the last two decades, India has made substantial gains with the sexual and reproductive health indicators. Progressive policies for maternal health have resulted in improved rates of institutional delivery and decline in the maternal mortality rate from 327 in 1999 to 2001 to 113 per 1 lakh live births in 2016-18, as per sample registration system data. So there had also been some significant shift in family planning in the past decade. And data from National Health Family Survey 5 for year 2019-20, which has came recently, that had shown how contraceptive prevalence has improved in most of these states. It means population control can be seen. So we ought to celebrate India's success as it significantly contributes to global progress, like current government with the programs like Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao. So it is improving girls or child sex ratio. Okay. That has made some efforts to challenge existing social norms and has underlined these that investments in social causes that must go alongside economic progress. All sections of society must embrace this call for positive change, and each is doing their part from the individual to the institutional level. So United Nations Fund for Population Fund is keen to take India's success models and strengthen South-South collaboration further. But there are certain challenges. Success is hard earned and never assured. And there are many challenges on the path to 2030, the goalpost for achieving the sustainable development goals. 2 million adolescent girls, like between 15 to 19 years, they each year had a pregnancy. And of these, nearly 63% were unwanted or unintended, as per the Guttmacher Institute 2021. So this points to inadequate information and access to sexual and reproductive health services for this age group. Girls who are aged between 15 to 19 years, are among those, 22.2% had an unmet need for contraception as per National Family Health Survey 4. Girls are still marrying too young. 26.8% of women aged between 20 to 24 years, they are married before they turn 18 and often having their first child within the first year of their marriage. Far too many girls and women, they face gender-based violence and harmful practices that are socially sanctioned. All of these practices are rooted in social norms, beliefs, and practices that deny women their bodily autonomy. It means they do not have their autonomy on their own body. So India had slipped 28 places to rank 140th among 156 countries, became third worst performers in South Asia in World Economic Forum's Global Gender Gap Report 2021. And this is the time to achieve the ambitious targets of Sustainable Development Goals is running out. India must hence choose its priorities carefully. Our analysis seems to suggest that placing youth, women, and girls at the center of policy making and services could trigger a positive ripple effect. If young people and adolescent girls in particular have access to education, relevant skills, information, and services to make healthy choices, which include related to sexual and reproductive health, they are empowered to exercise their rights, and they have access to opportunities for employment, then only India will be on a clear path to achieve goals of sustainable development goals. So research and practical experiences shows is that when women can make informed choices about their sexual and reproductive health, and when they have access to services to support their choices, societies are healthier and more productive. It means women need to understand their rights and their informed choices. Then only society can be productive and healthier. Women who has control over her body gains, not only in terms of autonomy, but also through advances in health, education, income, and safety, she is more likely to thrive, so in her family. So United Nations population fund that calls upon stakeholders to help build a new set of social norms to drive this mission. Okay, so this is all about this article. Moving on to the next one. So basically this article, if we talk about the crux of this article, so this is talking about women's and girls' rights, that they need to be informed then only on this population day when in population is in the favor of our country, positive demography we are having. So to understand the women and girls, they need to understand their right, they need to identify their bodily autonomy, okay, in terms of education, in terms of income support, income equality, okay, in terms of health services. Then only we would be able to establish a good society, a healthy society. Okay, moving on to the next one. A long road for migrant workers. Guidelines let down by Supreme Court are welcome, but they require robust system. So this is regarding the issues of migrant workers. What are those contexts is regarding on 29th June, Supreme Court has pronounced its judgment in the migrant laborer case. And the case was initiated last year after national lockdown had announced on 24th March. Thousands of landless laborers had started walking towards their home states because of loss of employment and income. So Supreme Court took cognizance of the matter on 26th May in 2020 and acknowledged the plight of workers in the light of the strict lockdowns. So court has laid down numerous guidelines to provide relief to workers and efficiently tackle the problem till the threat of COVID-19 subsides. Two of the most important components to protect the migrant during this time, that was food and travel arrangements insisted on by the courts. In orders pronounced in May this year, it laid down that dry ration to be provided to migrants who want to return to their homes. And further, the courts had said that identity proof should not be insisted upon by the government since the laborers might not be able to furnish it. Secondly, court has called upon the state government to arrange transportation for the workers who need to return to their homes. These guidelines by the court are crucial to ensure safety of workers. And Supreme Court has fixed July 31 as the deadline for the states to implement One Nation, One Ration Card scheme. And under this scheme, states are to complete the registration of migrant workers in order to provide dry ration to them. It is unlikely that a standardized system can be developed within the deadline prescribed by the court. Apart from dry ration, the top court also directed that the state government to run community kitchens for migrant workers. So there arises administrative problems in implementing these measures. First, migrant workers keep moving in the search of employment and it is difficult to cover them all under the scheme. Secondly, many states do not have the necessary infrastructure to run and maintain community kitchens on such a large scale. Under National Food Security Act, migrant workers are issued ration cards and they are now entitled to dry ration under various government programs like Atmanirbhar Bharat scheme, which has started initiated during the pandemic last year. So in the order which has been passed on June 29th, court has affirmed the right to food under Article 21 of the Constitution. In furtherance to this, court has asked the states to formulate their own schemes and issue food grains to migrants. This is an indispensable step to keep more than a fourth of the population of the country safe and healthy during the pandemic. There are no normative data that would allow the states to identify eligible migrants. The court took cognizance of the issue and directed the Ministry of Labor and Employment to ensure that the national database for unorganized workers is updated by 31st July. Finally, the top court recognized the need for direct cash benefit transfer to workers in the unorganized sector, but it did not issue any guidelines for the same as the workers need to be covered by the state themselves. And Supreme Court has also given a purposive declaration in the case that the bulk of judgment seems declaratory rather than mandatory. So in order to efficaciously implement the orders of the court, state governments need to work with the center closely. With the third wave of COVID-19 infections looming, it is imperative to ensure that government machinery works to its full potential and robust systems are developed to withstand the challenges. So this is all about this article. Moving on to the next one. This article is in the context of USA's withdrawal from Taliban. We have discussed lots of articles on this. So one more article is there. The surge, the Taliban should not be allowed to take control of Afghanistan through bloodshed. Basically, when USA had initiated its withdrawal, it means by September, they have to, by 9th of September, 11th of September, USA has said that USA will withdraw finally from Afghanistan. But before the onset of their withdrawal, what Taliban is doing? Basically, it is occupying various states, various localities in Afghanistan forcefully. Okay, so this article is talking about that Taliban should not take control of Afghanistan through bloodshed. If they want to take control over Afghanistan, here where democratic principle is already prevailing, so they need to adopt some other measures. Okay, so context is that rapid territorial gains made by Taliban over the last 2 months should worry both Afghan government and the regional powers who are invested in the country's long-term stability. Taliban had started their latest offensive on 1st May, the day remaining U.S. troops started withdrawing as parts of President Joe Biden's plan. With 90% of U.S. withdrawal complete, and Taliban have taken control of 195 of Afghanistan's 407 districts, and they are contesting for 129 others. Most of their recent victories are in the northern provinces of Badakhshan and Takhar that has resisted Taliban rule in 1990s. In several northern districts, Afghan troops have either surrendered or retreated. In the north, home to Afghanistan's elite power, brokers and leaders have lost, and the risk of total collapse of government in Kabul had been increased. So government still controls most of the provincial capitals and cities, but are practically surrounded by Taliban. And given the pace of the Taliban's advancement in countryside, it is possible that they could launch an offensive to take the population centers once the foreign troops are out of Afghanistan. So Taliban's strategy is still not clear. Their political office is in Doha that started peace talks with Afghan government representatives in September 2020. And it continued to say they are committed to the dialogue. But if we see on the battlefield in Afghanistan, they continue a relentless campaign which is aiming at capturing more and more territories. Part of the problem was the total abdication of the leadership and responsibility by the USA, which invaded Afghanistan 20 years ago, when direct talks between USA and Taliban had started. USA's focus was not on finding a peaceful settlement to the crisis, but it partly created, but on exiting the war. Therefore, instead of putting pressure on Taliban to extract concessions, USA struck a deal with them, completely ignored the concerns of Kabul. Now, Taliban is much more powerful on the ground, and even if peace progress is revived after America's pullout, they would negotiate with a position of strength. But that should not stop Kabul and regional powers like China, Russia, Iran, Pakistan, and India from seeking a political settlement. Violent takeover of the country by Taliban, like in 1996, what it has done, would not serve anybody's interest. And Taliban would also not find international legitimacy if they create Kabul, if they capture Kabul through bloodshed. Afghans' past experience suggests that one-party regimes, like a communist regime, Mujahideen or Taliban, they failed to stabilize the country or sustain themselves in the long run. Now, the invading troops are exiting Afghanistan. The warring parties are focusing, or their focus should shift towards settlement and building lasting structures of power. Else, Afghanistan would fall into another cycle of violence if it will not be controlled. So that is all about this article. Moving on to the next one. This is also regarding Afghanistan. So troubling prospects in Afghanistan as the realities of USA withdrawal takes hold. The future will depend on Taliban, Kabul dynamics and Pakistan's rule. So basically, this is a deep thoughts what has been discussed in this article. So recently, USA has handed over Bagram Air Base to the Afghan authorities that mark a symbolic end to its military presence. And USA force complete their withdrawal well ahead of the September 11 deadline that has been announced by American president. Familiar air of uncertainty surrounds Kabul as the Afghans ponder over the future of their land that ravaged by conflict for nearly 50 years. Afghanistan's immediate neighbors are now facing with the new challenge, how to persuade Taliban against overplaying their military hand, and especially this is the concern of India. So could anyone have predicted when USA commenced its military intervention in Afghanistan in October 2001 that it would get embroiled in the endless war of 20 years and to exit safely? It would have to negotiate with the Taliban, the same entity that it went into punish. It means for the Taliban, USA's troop came to Afghanistan in 2001, and without any war, without any tussle, they are peacefully exiting from Afghanistan after 20 years. So it has been a costly lesson for them. The war effort that cost $980 billion, over 2,400 US soldiers, plus 144 allied troops and 388 private military contractors have lost their lives over there. It has also spent $143 billion on reconstruction. Somewhere about $90 billion went for Afghan army, police, and other security forces, $36 billion for governance and economic developmental activities in Afghanistan, and balance on counter-narcotics and humanitarian relief works had been spent by USA. So the real price had been paid by Afghans. 20-year war has claimed the lives of nearly 50,000 Afghan civilians and nearly 70,000 Afghan security forces, majority during the last 7 years. That has added to it another 60,000 Afghan Taliban, and scale of the Afghan human loss becomes evident. So there have been gains too. In 2001, there were 9 lakh boys in the school. Today, 8 million children attend school and third are girls. Literacy is that has increased from 12% in 2002 to 35%. Life expectancy has also increased from 42 to 63 years. Urbanization has increased increased from 26 to 70% of the population. They watch TV. Urbanization is 60%, 70% of the population, they watch TV. From 320 miles of the paved roads in 2020, today, tarred roads over 10,000 miles are there in Afghanistan. Infant mortality rates have also brought down from 20% by over half. With a median age of 18.5 years, a majority of Afghans have grown up in a post-Taliban era. So today, they bear the brunt of 130 daily Taliban or IS Khorasan attacks, the highest since the USA ended combat operations in the end 2014. Tomorrow, even these limited gains are at risk after USA's withdrawal. So for USA President Bush, the objective was to build a stable, strong, effectively governed Afghanistan that won't degenerate into chaos. As US shifted from counterterrorism and counterinsurgency, shades of Vietnam began to emerge. Hamid Karzai's credit that had been seen the writing on the walls when he protested about the night raids and warned the Americans to either take the flight to safe havens and sanctuaries across the Durand line or make peace with the Taliban, but it only sought his relation with the USA. Eventually, US President Barack Obama diluted the objective of preventive Afghanistan from becoming a safe haven for global terrorism. He oversaw a successful operation to eliminate Osama bin Laden in 2011, implemented an unsuccessful military surge that concluded with an end to combat operations in end 2014, and Taliban had opened Doha office in 2013. US President Donald Trump saw himself as a deal maker, and in 2019, he initiated direct negotiations with the Taliban. Ambassador Zalmay Khalilzad, he was US Special Representative for Afghanistan Reconciliation, began by setting out four elements: ceasefire, cutting ties with Al-Qaeda and other terrorist groups, intra-Afghan peace talks, and withdrawal of all foreign military forces. That declare that nothing is agreed till everything is agreed. Within the months, Taliban had withheld down the USA demands till it got what it wanted. That was a withdrawal timeline not linked to the other factors. Additionally, Taliban managed to get the USA to push Kabul government to release over 5,000 Taliban cadres in the custody. Shortly, USA ended up legitimizing the Taliban at the expenses of the government in Kabul that they had worked to create and support. US President Joe Biden was no stranger to the Afghan dossier. He was convinced that USA had to exit from its quagmire of the forever wars. The US may have decided that it had no military options, but the Taliban are still pushing ahead militarily. So from less than a fifth today, over a third of Afghanistan's over 400 districts are under Taliban control. The day after exit from Bagram, 13 districts in Badakhshan, Takhar, Paktia, Kandahar fell to Taliban, and it has added to the 50 that have fallen since May. So in many of the cases, the local manning the security posts and checkpoints that have just surrendered villages and towns, there is already move towards the cities. Intra-Afghan talks in Doha have been in limbo for months. So here, General Austin S. Miller, who is commander, U.S. commander in Afghanistan, had indicated in the recent press conference that civil war is uncertain. Civil war is certainly a path that can be visualized if it continues on his on this trajectory. Dr. Abdullah Abdullah, who's chairman of High Council for National Reconciliation, had warned on 30th July that the truth is today the survival, security, and unity of Afghanistan is in danger. Ironically, the most vocal critics of USA over staying in Afghanistan and hinting that USA would never leave are the ones now blaming that USA for a hasty and irresponsible withdrawal. And in the coming months, as uncertainties mount, there will be increasing Taliban presence in the countryside as Kabul government concentrates on ensuring security in urban areas and of the road networks. So Taliban military strategy has been to target districts that enable them to surround provincial capitals. The clutch of Northeastern, including Badakhshan, Takhar, Kunduz, Baghlan, that enabled them to control Afghanistan-Tajikistan border and Wuhan corridor that links to China. So in the east, they also exert control in Ghazni, Kabul, Zabul, Paktia with Haqqani network, who's active in the coast and Paktika. And ISK is in Nangarhar and Kunar and Lagman. Then further south, Taliban control has controlled large parts of Kandahar, Helmand and Farah, which is bordering Iran. So as the reality when USA is withdrawing, okay, withdrawal takes hold, how events unfold by end 2021 depends on the factors. Will this not create terrorism complications in the world? Why most countries like US, Russia are not interested in the solution? Deco. Basically, USA, as we have discussed here, USA had spent too much of its monetarily financial resources. Not only financial resources, it's human resource as well. Many of the troops had died. Many of the allied troops had died. है ना तो इसके लिए क्या हुआ यूएसए अब बिकॉज यूएसए वाज सिंगल व्हाट से इन द यूनिपोलर वर्ल्ड यूएसए हैड टेकन केयर द टेररिज्म और टेररिज्म इशू इन अफगानिस्तान इन 2001 आफ्टर दैट अटैक ऑन ट्विन टावर ठीक है उसके बाद क्या हुआ अफगानिस्तान में आकर के दे हैव सेट अप देयर ओन मिलिट्री कैंप्स सो हियर लॉट्स ऑफ लॉसेस दे हैव फेस्ड इन दीस 20 इयर्स सो नाउ दे आर नॉट interested in the further staying in Afghanistan because of these losses. And if you remember, during Trump regime, in 2017, Donald Trump has said that India will help USA, India will help Afghanistan in its strategic development. Okay? So India is interested. India said, yes, we will do it. So here, the fund, what USA used to spend on Afghanistan, now USA will not do it. The burden will fall on India. That had been taken place during 2017. So now India, if USA will leave, okay, so USA is not interested in, because USA had understood that terrorism in Afghanistan or in these areas, these are unending, okay, there is no solution to it. But it doesn't mean that they will leave and they will go. Okay? It doesn't mean like that. Another thing is that if you are talking about Russia, so Russia, China, Pakistan, they have, a relationship. Okay, they have established a nexus, a relationship. China and Russia, China and Pakistan. Pakistan is the terrorist heaven, you know, terrorist heaven country. So here, that is the threat. So Russia had appeared as a threat, not as a crusader. Okay, so Russia, Russia will not do anything to control terrorism or to work on the issue of terrorism. But Russia had It's a what's a relationship with China, China's relationship with Pakistan. So what they will do, basically, they can only establish their trade relations. They can only establish their diplomatic relations, whatever they will feel so that it is fruitful or it is negligible. They can do it. But regarding what USA has done, it is impossible to do by these countries. And as I've said, strategic development of India. So India was interested in doing that, but alone it cannot do it. Okay. So here problem is that USA, okay, USA had to leave, USA is leaving, but they need to conclude the peace talk with Taliban. This is the crux of this article. Okay, this is the crux of this article, that in USA, before leaving, they need to resolve this Taliban issue once and for all. Okay, so most of the areas had been taken over by Taliban, and another areas, these are under the control of different terrorist groups. Okay, so the reality of USA withdrawal takes hold, and that can be unfolded by end of 2021, depends on three factors. What are those factors? That depends. India need to do it, okay? But that depends whether they will be on similar terms or not, because Taliban, we know, terrorist group is in Afghanistan. India is a democratic country. India had already its relationship with the democratic country, democratic politics in Afghanistan, okay? So here, Taliban has become a challenge for India. So let's see what happens in the coming future. India is already tackling with the COVID-19 problem in its country, economic issues in its country. Let's see what India will do in Afghanistan. Okay, because with Afghanistan, we are having a relationship kind of diplomatic, a relationship kind of social. Okay, many Afghan students, they come to India study. Okay, medical tourism, India have with Afghanistan. Education tourism is India is having with Afghanistan. So here, India need to establish its relation or ties with Taliban, it is required. But what India will do, that we will see in the future. Okay. अब देखो ये चीज जो है ना कि इंडिया अकेला पड़ जाएगा या इंडिया अकेला, दिस इज नॉट ट्रू इन केस ऑफ इंटरनेशनल रिलेशंस. इफ यू आर रिप्रेजेंटिंग अ कॉन्टिनेंट, इफ यू आर रिप्रेजेंटिंग अ कंट्री, इट मींस यू हैव सम पावर, इट मींस यू हैव सम स्ट्रेंथ, सो दैट यू नीड टू शो. ठीक है, वहां पे बेचारा नहीं बनना, इससे अच्छा आप अपनी कंट्री में रहो. ओके, so we'll see in the coming days, in the coming future, what India will take stand on this matter. Now, so what are those three factors? First is that, have Taliban changed their ideological colors? Matlab, their ideology is what? Terrorism. Okay, so USA recently, Pakistan for much longer have been pushing this line, but Taliban leadership gave no clue about it. Related to this is the question of Taliban unity. Distance have grown between the Quetta Shura and Doha negotiators and the fighters who want to guard their individual preserves. And this work as long as everyone is pursuing the military option, but when it comes to power sharing, who calls the shots? Or does it lead to no power sharing? Secondly, can Kabul regime present a unified front? If the leaders in Kabul and the government continue snipping at each other, it will adversely impact the integrity of the chain of command of the Afghan security forces. Then if opportunistic leaders are tempted to strike their own deals with Taliban, it will only hasten the collapse and even Western funding will dry up. Third, final factor is, Pakistan still seeking strategic depth in Afghanistan, or has it realized that Taliban-dominated Kabul will be a magnet for its own homegrown extremists as well as those from the neighborhood? So can it persuade the Taliban that its legitimacy will be at risk unless it shares powers? And Pakistan's influence will weaken once Rehbari Shura decides to move back from Quetta to Afghanistan. And history tells us that in Afghanistan, there have only been winners and losers, seldom any lasting compromises. So so Afghanistan has become a very terrible land for all such stakeholders, whether it is Taliban, Pakistan, whether it is India, whether it is democratic rule in Afghanistan. Okay, and other terrorist groups in Afghanistan. So USA, okay, USA had to leave, but before leaving, they need to resolve this issue of terrorism, because Taliban will be now an open ground for all such terrorist activities, and the world is facing global terrorism. This risk will enhance. This risk will increase after this withdrawal. So that may be possible in the coming future. Okay. So here basically it is saying in the last that Pakistan, who's having good relations with Taliban, but Taliban basically they are not unified. One sector it is it has been installed in Western Afghanistan. One is installed in the Eastern Afghanistan. So here a kind of linkage problem is there within Taliban. So let's see what is going to happen in future. Now, next article about tracking fugitive everywhere. In the absence of a coordinated database, criminals can go undetected. Basically, this is again regarding the political prisoners. Okay, so a proper database is required to detect criminals who are serving the prison, who have escaped the prison. Okay, so context is that Indian law on extradition is spread across the Indian Penal Code, as well as various laws pertaining to narcotic drugs, information technology, hijacking, and so procedural law has code of criminal procedures as their backbone, but there are other laws too, like Extradition Act, Narcotics Drugs, Psychotropic Substances Act, Prevention of Corruption Act, Prevention of Money Laundering Acts, and etc. So there are different offenses, and offenders can be booked in different cases as per their crime. So the bulk of the investigation and prosecution, that work happens at the police stations in the state. While central agencies, they take important cases only. It means what? It means whenever we track, whenever we book any accused, what happens? Investigation and process prosecution work, that happens in the state police stations of the state government. And central agencies can only take up important cases like CBI. Okay, what they do? They do not take every cases. They take only important cases. So central agencies have developed reasonable expertise because they are focused only on the investigation and prosecution work. And state police forces, except specialized wings, they are engaged in law and order as well as investigations. Okay, this is the area of work. So there is a tendency to close investigations once the accused have absconded, and an overwhelming tendency to bank on statements obtained from the accused or during interrogation before closing investigations. So it would be interesting to know what proportion of arrest warrants obtained by investigation agencies of states that pertain to persons who have absconded or wanted, whether within India or abroad. So some police stations, they do initiate proceedings for attachment of property and declaration of the accused as proclaimed offenders. But the number of cases where coordinated efforts are made to pursue fugitives domestically or internationally, they are hardly documented. It means no documentations are done by the state police stations. So number of red corner notices are being issued for any indications. Only about 750 such criminals are wanted by Indian agencies. Okay, they have declared as wanted. And number of blue corner notices issued is about 300. So theoretically, there exists a system of tracking criminal worldwide through Interpol notices, sharing of immigration databases of different countries, but there is no coordinated service system or database for tracking criminals or wanted persons domestically. It means internationally we have Interpol. Okay, but there is no such facility in the country. So in the absence of such a system, it is relatively easy for criminals for one police station or jurisdiction to melt into the population in any other area. Almost they get undetected. So there is a requirement to create a nationwide database of wanted persons that could be accessible for police agencies, public and others like passport, immigration authorities. So it is imperative. Crime and criminal tracking network and system and national intelligence grid are efforts in the right directions, but more integration is required. It is desirable. Perhaps nationwide system of wanted persons notice similar to Interpol notices is required. It will help to track fugitives domestically. Many a times it happens like accused, they get escaped from the jail. So what happens? There is no record of that person. He is a criminal. He is living he is living freely in the society. So there is need to have some database to track those fugitives. Countries like USA have functional interstate extradition fugitive tracking systems. India need to set up such dedicated fugitive tracking units. There is also a need to be enhanced integration between immigration agencies, state police agencies, Interpol, New Delhi External Affairs Minister and Home Ministry and Central Investigation Agencies. Intelligence agencies are also need to pool in this. Okay. So what may also help India to plug loopholes in sharing its wanted database or providing access to it to foreign embassies on a reciprocal basis or through treaties or arrangements? All this will help detect possible plans of criminals to abscond abroad. Signing off more bilateral and multilateral conventions on criminal matters would help plug legal affirmatives. Signing bilateral agreements. Achha dekho, why this article we are discussing about? Many of the times we have seen, like Nirav Modi case, like Mehul Choksi case, like Vijay Mallya case. What happens? They commit a crime and they leave the country. They start living in the other country. And it is illegal to catch that offender from that country, whether he is from India or not, because he has taken citizenship of a different country. So it is now illegal to touch that person. So there is a requirement to sign bilateral and multilateral conventions on the criminal matters. And signing bilateral agreements on cooperation in policy matters would also help in this. So all relevant legal processes and requirements should be incorporated into one consolidated law on international cooperation. Entire gamut of activities that pertains to fugitives from investigation to extradition that needs to be incorporated into the specialized setup with an integrated international cooperation division at the top. Then this integrated international cooperation division should have linkages with the proposed fugitive tracking units at the state level. Matlab ek central level pe ho gaya. At the top, it is IICD. Okay. This IICD need to have its linkages with fugitive tracking system or units which is working at the state level. It will ensure that requisite which is expertised and forward and backward linkages had been created. So it will make system watertight. It will deter criminals from hoodwinking the law. It means it will track the fugitive and it will take him under the control of law. Okay, so this is all about this article. Moving on to the next one. In the defense of India's noisy democracy, in the current moment, it is important to be clear why comparisons with China are not only specious but also dangerous. Basically, it is this article is discussing about a difference between authoritarian regime and democracy. Which is better, China's authoritarian regime or India's democracy? India's democracy, here we are having multiple political parties, multiple political parties. It means BJP is there, Congress is there. So if we are not happy with BJP, then we'll opt for Congress. If we are not happy for the Congress, we'll opt for BJP and vice versa. It happens in India, okay, in the democratic system. But if we see China, there is Communist Party, there is an authoritarian regime, there is one person rule in the country. So how efficient both the rules are, how they are, and China is largest populated country of the world. India is second largest populated country of the world. Okay, there is a comparison. China under authoritarian regime, one person rule, what it is doing, it is basically aspiring. It is basically, it has improved its economic situation. Assertion we have seen, hostilities of China we have seen. And militarily it is strong, economically it is strong, politically it is strong. It has tackled COVID-19 situation very efficiently. The origin of the COVID-19 had taken place in China. It has spread throughout the world, but it has controlled in its own country. So here this article is discussing what is good in authoritarian regime, what is good in what is bad in the authoritarian regime, and what is good and bad in the democratic system. Okay. So context is that China's developmental pathway over the last century has been spectacular. No country in history has ever grown faster and more dynamically. Not only hundreds of millions have been Lifted out of poverty, and but social indicators, just a moment. So India's development, so not only have hundreds of millions been lifted out of poverty, but social indicators have improved dramatically. India's developmental records have been much more mixed. Like since 1990s, Indian economy has grown impressively, but it remains far behind China in the global competitiveness. Poverty has come down, but employment prospect for the majority remains limited to the low wage informal sector jobs. Okay, by their definition, it is precarious. So... So maybe most startling of all, improvements in basic social developmental indicators have lagged. So much so that Jean Deraise and Amartya Sen have pointed out that India has actually fallen behind Bangladesh and Pakistan in many of the ways. Okay, so comparing these track records, some commentators that include voices in the government have drawn a facile lesson. India's problem is that it is just too democratic. Too much democracy is there in the country. Unlike China, making and implementing key decisions about public investment and various reforms is impossible in the din of multiple and contradictory democratic voices. And that is what is needed are firmer and more independent forms of decision making that is insulated from the cacophony. So this line of thinking has at various times been embraced by sections of left, that is Leninism, and multilateral technocrats and bankers, but increasingly it has become the animating fantasy of right-wing leaders and movements that range from elected autocrats like Donald Trump, Brazil's Jair Bolsonaro, and Narendra Modi. So the strangeness of these bedfellows alone should be cause for alarm, but in the current moment, it is especially important to be clear why comparisons with China are not specious, but very dangerous. The claim that less democracy is good for development does not stand up to comparative, theoretical, and ethical scrutiny. Contrary to those who believe economic management cannot be left to the whims of democratic forces, the comparative evidence clearly shows that democratic regimes have on balance performed better than the non-democratic regimes. China, with the history of state building going back to millennia and an exceptionally well-organized, disciplined, and brutal form of authoritarianism, has done especially well in transforming its economy under who was the leader? I'm forgetting the leader. Mao Zedong. Okay, so under Mao Zedong, we have seen that India, China has grown well. Okay, its economy has grown very well. So Africa and West Asia were authoritarian regime. So under China under authoritarian regime, it has improved its economy. But the flip side can be seen. Africa, many of the African countries, there we can see there is authoritarian regime. West Asia, authoritarian regime. So authoritarian governments over these places, they are of every stripe, have dominated authoritarian government. It remained world economic laggards. They are lagging in economy, in the world economy. Latin American military dictatorships of early 1960s and 1970s had a terrible economic and social record. And it was with the return of democracy and the pink wave of left populist parties that prosperity and social progress had assured over there. Taiwan and South Korea are also instructive. Their economic takeoffs happened under military regimes and relied on labor repression. Their transitions to democracy saw their economies moving up to the next level and became much more inclusive. Okay, so here these are positives of democracy. So most pointedly though, one only has to look within India to understand how development and democracy can thrive together. By just about any measure, Kerala and Tamil Nadu have done more to improve the lives of all their citizens across the caste and classes than any other states in India. And it is no coincidence that both have also had the longest and most sustained popular democratic movements and intense party competition in the country. In the contrast, Gujarat, where single party BJP has ruled, rule has been in place for nearly a quarter century. Growth has been solid, but accompanied by increased social exclusion and stagnation in the educational achievements and poverty reduction. So Gujarat has done good economically, but educationally and inclusion. social inclusion, that is on the decline. So comparative records leaves little doubt that unbalanced democracies are better at promoting inclusive growth. The theory behind authoritarian fantasy also does not hold up. First, the assumption that authoritarian supports forms of decision-making that can rise above the hub of democratic demand making to get things done presumes that those in the command will serve the general interest rather than catering to the powerful, and that when they enjoy such autonomy and they actually know what to do with it. This is just hubris. So on both these points, democracies are in fact more likely to meet the necessary conditions for successful decision making. Elected representatives, no matter how venal, have to win re-election. That means answering to a broad swath of the electorate. Now, democracy generates complications. How? Conflict and noise that democracy generates may complicate things, but at the end, having to respond to a broad spectrum of interest and identities not only protects against catastrophic decisions, but actually it allows for forms of negotiations and compromise that can bridge across interest, and even it can balance conflicting imperatives for growth, justice, sustainability, and social inclusion. So remarkable progress of UPA government that made a building to build a welfare state under NG Narega, right to information, right to food and other programs. That was a testament to how a democracy can master even during the worst complex policy goals. Then as a democratic theorist have long been argued, the common good cannot and should not be determined by science, profits, technocrats, or autocratic fiat. What it is and how we get there can only emerge out of sustained societal deliberation. Okay, so this is what positive of democracy. Now, democracy in India, what we have versus rule in China. So India's tries with democracy was born not only of its liberation movement, but also of its affinity with what makes democracy ethically unique. And it has promoted equality by endowing all citizens with the same civic, political, and social rights, even as it protects and nurtures individuality and difference. And this is where China-India comparison is so problematic. Indeed, it is unconscionable. But one might like to measure or evaluate China's development success. There is no way to discount the human cost of the party-made great famine that took some 35 million lives. Even you remember, before independence of India, too much famine used to occur in India. But after independence of India, we have not seen such instances in our country. But that had been seen in China. Okay, a great famine had been taken place, which took away 35 million lives. Cultural revolution that made enemies out of neighbors. One child policy of China had devastated families and erased a generation, or violent systematic repression of Uyghur, Muslim, and Tibetan minorities had been seen. So these were not unfortunate excesses or the inevitable cost of development. These were and are the irredeemable instincts and predations of an authoritarian state. One, which can denounce as historical nihilism any interpretations of the past that challenge the party's official history. Conversely, while India's democracy had been quarrelsome, cumbersome, and often dominated by elites, it has also opened social and political spaces for subordinate groups, and it has built a sense of shared identity and belonging in the world's largest and most diverse society. It has preserved individual liberties, group identities, and religious and thought freedoms, all the things that confer recognition on human beings. To even pose the question of a trade-off between these freedoms and the role they have played in building a pluralistic nation and some quote utilitarian calculus of development, not only it does violence to very ideal of human agency and dignity, but completely abstract the very different social and historical realities of India and China. So at the end of this article, what it has said that democracy in India is far, far better than authoritarian regime of China. So beyond these comparative arguments for democracy, one need to look no further than the object lesson the BJP government has provided to dismiss the authoritarian fantasy. The democratic backsliding has been clear. Government has not only sought to centralize, insulate the and personalize the decision making, but also aggressively undermine the independence of democratic institutions. And it has also been silenced and imprisoned opposition voices, all in the name of nationalism and promoting development. So this is what it is not acceptable in democracy, what it is going on in the name of democracy under BJP rule. So development track is dismissal at the best. While corporate business interest and billionaire class have flourished, overall economy has sputtered. And since COVID-19, we have experienced the worst contraction of any sizable economy in the world. What is the situation of India right now? Demonetization, disaster response to the second wave of COVID-19, that was not just instances of utter policy incoherence. That has been fueled by fancy and myopia that comes with an inwardly focused government. But it has exposed a degree of callousness and arrogance rarely seen in the democracy. On the social front, the pursuit of Hindutva, that is a prototypical variant of authoritarian ethnic nationalism, had shaken India's democratic norms and institutional foundations and weaponized a politics of polarization and demonetization that had threatened to unravel the social fabric of the nation. Rather than looking to China, it is time to defend the noise of Indian democracy. So here, there is no comparison between authoritarian regime and democracy. Democracy is far better than authoritarian regime of China. But we need to understand what democracy is required in our country. What was there in our country? It was all inclusive. In the name of nationalism, we cannot impose undemocratic ideas on the country. So this is all about this article. Moving on to the next one. Undead section. The invalid section 66A is often invoked out of ignorance, but serves as a tool of harassment. Basically, section 66A that had been struck down by Supreme Court. But many of the police stations or many of the police officers, they book accused under this section 66A, and it has become a tool of harassment for them. So booking any accused under section 66A, it is now illegal, it is now invalid, but still they've been booked, they've been harassed. Okay, so article is talking about, the context is about that it is quite disconcerting that Supreme Court has been informed that the second time in 2 years that section 66A of the IT Act, which was struck down as unconstitutional 6 years ago. It was said that it was unconstitutional. It is still being invoked by the police and some trial courts. So one can see why court deemed it a shocking state of affairs when a petition by the People's Union for Civil Liberties came up for hearing. Section 66A made messages deemed by the police to be offensive or menacing to anyone or those that cause annoyance, a criminal offense, if these were sent through a computer or computer resource. It prescribed a prison term of up to 3 years on conviction. In its landmark judgment in Shreya Singhal, the court has ruled that provisions was vague and violated the freedom of free speech. Then it was broadly defined that it took into its sweep protected speech also, and therefore it has upset the balance between the exercise of the free speech right and imposition of reasonable restrictions on it. Then in January 2019, court's attention was drawn to the same problem of the invalidated provisions that is being used by the police to register cases based on the complaints. Not much has been seen to have changed since then. And it is quite surprising that the police headquarters and prosecutors in the various states have not disseminated the effect of the court ruling among officers that manning the police stations. So there were also instances of the courts that framed charges under Section 66A, even after lawyers had cited the 2015 judgment of the Supreme Court that it has been struck down. So POCL has said as many as 745 cases are still pending in the district courts in 11 states who had been booked or registered under Section 66A. So it is not difficult to surmise that police officers who receive complaints and register them as first information reports may not be aware of the judgment. Though one cannot rule out instances of the section being invoked deliberately as a tool of harassment. By ignoring of the law is no excuse for the citizen, and it must equally be no excuse for police officers who include invalidated sections in FIRs. Recently, it was found that police in Uttar Pradesh have booked a journalist for the defamation under Section 500 of the IPC. Even the Supreme Court has ruled that defamation can be pursued only by the way of private complaints and there cannot be a FIR. Current hearing may result in directions of the states and police as well as the court registries for appropriate advisories to both station house officers and magistrates, but it is not necessary for those concerned to wait for such orders. So, police chiefs and the directorates of prosecution must proactively begin a process of conveying to the lower courts and investigators all important judgments and their effect on the practices relating to investigation, prosecution, and framing of charges from time to time. So this is all about the article. This is all about the day. I hope it is, whatever we have discussed, it is helpful for you. Any questions you can ask here, else I'll end the session. Chalo. So thank you so much. Have a nice. Take care. Bye-bye.